hear what I hear.
Fuck yourself, choke yourself.
shark, future shark, fuck yourself, fuck yourself. Use this information. Welcome to the GroypCast. I am Charlie Kirk's teeth groyper. Tonight I have a
Hey, what's going on?
I have Shallot.
Hey, how's everyone doing?
And we also have our good friend Parker.
Howdy, howdy.
And our special guest tonight, of course, Steve Franssen. How's it going, Steve?
Hey, what's up, guys? Good to be here.
And I'll go ahead and turn it over to Gibby, and he'll keep us going.
Yes. So, Steve, we have a few questions for you regarding, you know, Zoomers, Millennials, being online, bug people, gutter people, beta males. I think the first question is, what should young Zoomers like myself and many others, you know, many other Groypers, Nickers, do to avoid becoming like these bug people, these people obsessed with just like consuming and pleasure? What should be the number one thing we should do to avoid that?
Oh, man. Well, I think you should have a low time preference. I mean, you should really have impulse control and, you know, whatever IQ you're batting at. Like a lot of guys come to me and they're like, oh, Steve, I'm not that smart. I'm screwed. And it's like, well, that's tough. I mean, but clarity of thinking will get anybody or most anybody over the line. If they have clarity of thinking and if they're consistent and they're persistent, in long-term goals. Like I've seen simps, dude. I've seen simps adopt low time preferences and then they like get nice jobs because they grind it out at work. They are patient with women and they get everything going for themselves. So, I mean, I've seen like simpy dudes do really well for themselves. So I think at the bare minimum, Zoomers need to have some low time preference. I mean, that's what built the West.
That's a really good answer. And of course with Zoomers, there's a lot more space to grow, a lot more opportunity because a lot of us, we are young. We haven't made mistakes that would ruin our lives or permanently change the course of our lives yet. But millennials have kind of been this example, almost this cautionary tale of what not to do with the generation, with how bad that they've turned out. You know, no offense to you and other millennials host or millennials watching, but do you think that the millennial generation can be saved or is even worth saving?
Well, they bat like 70% Democrat or something like this. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, I am a pretty unique millennial. Vince James is a pretty unique millennial. You would say Patrick Casey's a millennial. I chose from a very young age, I went to college and I watched this meat grinder, this like Chappelle show, easy sex, bad jokes, lots of student loan debt, meat grinder, just turn everyone into socialists. And so I really turned away from that. And I saw everyone cooming. I mean, I saw all my millennial compatriots just cooming. And to all the Zoomers out there, never underestimate the wickedness and the corrosive power of cooming. I mean, you know, you coom like 50 times in a year and your year is screwed. You know, even like 10 times in a year, your year is screwed. You have to have some degree of sensitivity to wake up to what's going on, because basically what's happening is we're being terraformed. We're being terraformed into like bug men. And the millennials got it bad. I mean, the millennial generation is pretty screwed. So I don't know. I'm kind of black-pilled on the millennial question, but I'm really white-pilled on the Zoomer question. And Generation Alpha after Zoomers or whatever you want to call them, I'm super white-pilled on them. It's just like, where do we want to put our efforts? I mean, I put my efforts into millennials. And there's too much cooming. Like your brain is like fully formed by age 25. There's too much simping. There's too much cooming. I mean, everyone that was a millennial is now like over the age of 25. And so their personalities, all these guys, I mean, I write about it in my book, Torturing the Villagers. I write about like watching all the guys around me just drop like flies and being really confused about this, you know, and just knowing I shouldn't coom. And knowing I should turn to God and stuff like this. you know, this stuff gets crystallized into the personality, and people become corrupt. People become corrupt in their late 20s. They either turn back to the family and they turn back to God, or they become leftists, and that sort of becomes crystallized in the personality. And if you coom enough, I mean, that speeds up the process. So millennials, I'm sorry, they get a thumbs down from me, at least right now. I haven't been impressed. And quite frankly, you know, a lot of these millennials didn't grow up with much internet. And so they just don't know the vibe. They just don't know how to schmood. And so, and a lot of them aren't really gamers. So I don't know. I have a lot of negative things to say about millennials, but I believe that if I am hopeful for anybody, at least on an interpersonal basis, then someone can get something out of what I'm saying. So I guess that's a cautionary sort of harangue there.
Yes, and when you mentioned cooming, you don't just mean like, you know, pornography or porn addiction. I assume you mean all types of like premarital sex, anything that's not in marriage that could be considered sexual degeneracy, right?
Yeah, yeah, totally. I mean, you know, BJs, HJs, you know, even like, what are you doing like necking too hard? I mean, some people are even like, they're necking and petting. It's like, calm down. I mean, you got to keep your head on a swivel. You got to see these women for what they are. They're dangerous.
Yes. And it's, I like that you mentioned millennials aren't really gamers. They're not really online. I think there's this weird component to both video games and being extremely online. It almost takes your attention so much away from cooming. Now, of course, it could be used for bad. You have, you know, porn sites. You have games with, like, you know, scantily clad anime girls. But mainly, it just takes your focus away from that and directs it to something else. It might not be productive in and of itself, but it keeps you from doing something that's way more destructive.
Yeah, big agree.
So, what do you think is... I know you're married, and you have a child, and that's great. You know, more people should be having families, more people should be having kids, but a lot of young people are finding it very difficult, young men in particular, to find a wife and start a family. Should young men focus on finding a family and finding a wife now when they're in their early 20s, or should they maybe wait until they have more capital, you know, more money to start a family, maybe when they're late 20s and 30s?
Oh man, I go back and forth on this because, you know, the one thing that I always wish every day is that I had more time with my family, more time with my kids. I'm painfully aware of how short their childhoods are. And so that's something to think about. It's like, if you want to start a family, how much do you want to play that sexual market value game where you're upping your stats before you enter the market, so you get the highest girl possible, the highest score out of a girl possible, versus getting time with your family? I mean, a big thing I've been pushing for lately is like, yo, if this girl's got baby fever and you can reasonably like wrangle her for the foreseeable 25 years, just pull the trigger, just go for it. I mean, just have kids, wife up, get going. And anyone that's in that position, I think, is very fortunate. But for the guys out there that are struggling or that are thinking, you know, fuck femoids, I'm done with girls, never going to talk to girls. It's like, well, turn some of that drive, some of that tenacity, turn that toward improving yourself. And then you'll find that girls are just falling into your lap. It's not that difficult. You just got to make a little money. You have to have a little money saved up. And you got to figure out how you're charming, like how you as a person are charming and appealing to others. That involves a little bit of self-knowledge. And then, of course, you don't coom because that builds up your primal energies, your tiger blood. You know, that makes you connected to the pineal gland. It gives you that extra dragon force. And that, I think, really has a seductive and empowering effect on men, and it puts you in a position to succeed. So, in a question of timing, I don't know, man. Just like, be a beast. Beast out. Don't coom. Just be strong and then just take.
Yes, and where should, like, young men try to find reasonably quality girls? You know, there's this whole fantasy of, like, trad wives and wheat fields, and that's all pretty unrealistic, but where would be a good place for them to find a good woman, and what are the qualities that they should look for in, like, a potential wife?
Well, you know, you don't want a girl with a high body count because that sort of atomizes her capacity to form love bonds. You know, she won't care about your kids as much. She won't love you as much because, you know, once they get over like 7 or 8, even 10, I could stretch it up there. I mean, that's so bad. It's so degenerate, but we have to look at the research a little bit. It's like, you don't want a woman like that. She's a gray woman. She's like a permanent NPC in a way. She broke something in herself. So I think that's the big red flag. But where you should find girls is in society. It seems like a silly answer, but it's like, where are people? Okay, go there. Okay, now talk, you know, and be seen. Make an ass out of yourself. I mean, I was so girl crazy in middle school and high school and college. So girl crazy. And I got so many reps just from being girl crazy. And then that led me to the woman that is my wife now. And we've been together for 10 years now. You know, very trad, very buttoned up, very put together, very respectful and all that. But that's because I got my reps and I just chose to be around women. And I filtered out the bad women when I got the sense that they were whores. Or, well, this is another thing. Is it like you want a girl, you want a woman that will change her mind? Because inevitably, you're never going to find a woman that's like fully red-pilled. Because if she's fully red-pilled, then a man has had his paws all over her. And, you know, it's like extremely rare that a woman is red-pilled because of her father. Most Gen X fathers now are like total simps and total losers and total nihilists. So the quality of parenting of females that are fertile right now, what they went through, wasn't very good. So for those of you that are like, oh, I found this red pill girl, I'm like, well, tread carefully. But you do want a girl that'll change her mind. You want her to be somewhat agreeable anyway, so that she'll come along with you and she'll do what you want to do so that you can be the leader of the family, so that there's no big fight and there's no like feminist showdown.
Nice, nice. So it's any of this wisdom about femoids or about how not to become a simp in your book, Torturing the Villagers, or any of your other books?
Yeah, I deal with it. I deal with cooming and simping pretty extensively in Torturing the Villagers. You know, I've got an essay just here on e-girls, and I'm just talking directly to the e-girl. I say, if you need to show me your boobs, I don't care what you have to say, especially if you already have a man in your life. It's one thing to be prowling about for a man. I can kind of understand that, but not really. If you have a nice figure, it'll show in a full sweater. You know, I'm talking about e-girls showing off their boobs, right?
Yeah.
I get that it's a business strategy. Sex sells. Known that since forever. But I think you're showing off your tits as a show of power. I don't give a fuck if you're a libertarian, peaceful parent who's been through 5 years of psychotherapy. Like, there are legit e-girls out there that have, like, done stuff like this and come from decent intellectual backgrounds, and they're still just trying to pull in the simps. And then there's e-girls that disrespect Christianity. Nobody has a foothold in with you other than your man, and if he's willing to tolerate his woman using her chess weapons to gain clout, then he's not strong and probably likes you because of your fucked up relationship to men. So, like, there's even, like, trad girls out there that I'm like, what are you doing? You just want attention. And you should get out of politics. Stop it. Stop talking about politics. Like, you know, and the good ones are the trad girls. Like, they just are supportive. You know, like, I have come to really like Brittany Pettibone because she's just supportive. You know, I'm not going to say she's a trad girl or whatever. You know, she's done some stuff. She wrote a book for women or whatever. But she's just, like, supportive. And she keeps them covered up. And she's got, like, a warm personality. And that's that. She's not like trying to hook in a bunch of attention for herself. She's not trying to be a big star. She's not on some big Ayn Randian head trip. Like she thinks she's like a heroine in some film or something like this. You know, she's just nice. She's just supportive. And really, that's the ideal. I think in a lot of ways, that's what we want from our women is supportiveness, warmth. We want them to be good with the kids. But when we talk politics, they kind of need to stay in their lane, you know. I could use more coarse language there, but I'll just be nice about that. It's good when they can just stay in their own lane a little bit.
Yeah, it's good when they get back in the kitchen. Us at the Daily Grofer, I think you just take a look at our website and realize you're not a big fan of e-girls or women in politics. So we absolutely agree with you. Now, this essay, is this in your book or is this on your website?
Yeah, it's in the book. It's, you know, the essay is called E-Girls. And then the next essay is called Kings to Mentor. It's all about these confidence hucksters, these fucking dickweeds that like want to pull in Zoomers because they think that Zoomers are like, you know, hey, I'm a king just like you guys. You know, join my email list, buy my fucking supplements. These nubheads that think that they're going to like, you know, push the movement in their direction. I mean, I talk about those guys a lot too. I talk about these like grifter guys that are always trying to hook in our guys and try to appeal to some, you know, vanity. Like they build up all these muscles for themselves, but they aren't gamers. It's like, fuck you, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's like, they also appeal to coomers. I think I know exactly who you're talking about. Like Andrew Tate and Ed Lattimore. They're like, join my chess program and you'll learn how to pick up women. It's just ridiculous shit like this. And these are not the people that you should be idolizing. The people that you should be looking up to are people trying to make a difference in the movement. You know, people like you, people like Patrick Casey, Nick, Jake, even like if you're looking for like an example to lead in life. Yeah. Then look at people like you and Vince James who have built up good families for yourselves, found a wife, living reasonably well, not these people, you know, flexing rented Lamborghinis.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, fundamentally, I mean, I'd be curious to hear what you guys think about this, all of you, but what matters is victory. I mean, that's all that matters. The demographic cliff is coming. Like we need to do everything we can to be prepared and to like have a very, very strong position. And anybody that isn't leveling with young people about that right now is a total waste of time. They're a total waste of space. They're just grifting you. They're just wasting your time. They're part of the managed decline. They're just buying time for the third world to pour in. Like these guys don't want to talk immigration. They don't want to talk demographics. And so if you can't build your foundation on top of that as a man, appealing to other men, you're useless. You're worse than useless. You're like a distraction. So, but I'd love to hear what you guys think about that.
Oh yeah, absolutely. No, there's no space for these people. Like you said, just they're grifters. They're obviously grifters. So I think Andrew Tate, his PhD was a pimp and hose degree program to pick up women. Mm-hmm. It's something crazy, like $800 for a couple of videos. Like these people we should not associate with these people. We should not like their tweets. We should not interact with them at all. We should completely excise them.
Oh yeah.
Charlotte Parker, you got any thoughts on this?
Yeah. I kind of wanted to go back earlier where as this kind of ties into the demographic change as well. So you see a lot of fear with, I guess, more of the millennial crowd, borderline Zoomer of, how early is too early to start the family? Like you mentioned, build up some savings and make sure you have a good income because obviously you want to take care of your family. But transitioning into demographic change, we have a lot of non-white, more government-dependent families that are actually out growing us in terms of demographics. So to kind of quell that fear, what is there a metric you have to define, like what is the moment where this is right? Or is it just this feels right or you will know in the moment kind of thing?
Well, I think, you know, You need your kings. I've noticed this, and it's like the more guys that are concentrated, that has like a multiplying power. Every guy that is in a group, is in a friend group. I mean, this is why it's so cool what's going on with the Groypers, what Nick is doing, how he's bringing together an alliance. You know, we're stronger when we stand together, us that have these values and are willing to speak the moral truths of the day. If you can bring your kings together like that, then it has this like synergistic power that makes it a lot safer for you to have children. I think a lot of guys want to chase girls, you know, because they're lonely, and loneliness is a huge epidemic, and getting a girl takes care of a lot of loneliness, but it leaves you, you know, like you need your kings to vet her or whatever. So I would almost say talking about like going after women is almost like putting the cart before the horse for a lot of people, because, you know, a lot of guys just don't have friends, and you should be willing to do whatever it takes to be around your fellow Groypers, your fellow guys, like move across the country, you know, whatever it takes. A lot of people are meeting through networks like White Date. I know where the world's got that going on. A lot of guys are coming together because they're Groypers. Like, do whatever it takes, you know, whatever's most advantageous for you guys, come together in that way and then work from that position. It'll be a lot more conducive to a family atmosphere, and you'll feel a lot more confident, a lot more secure in your decision to go ahead and start a family when you know that, like, you know, you got Godfather Groyper over here. He's like willing to take on your kids if you get cut down in the Groyper wars, you know, or you've got, you got your like cousin's friend over here, you know, he's looking out for you. He's a fellow gamer and he gets it. Like, just that layer of things. I mean, we used to have that through the church, right? And that's how so many people would just go ahead and they get married. And there was so much baby fever in the United States. It was really exciting times. And I think we can have some sort of approximation of that, but it all comes from coming together and ruthlessly gatekeeping simps and coomers and cringe guys, like guys who really cringe, guys like gatekeeping wignats. Don't let wignats in your circles. Only Groypers, like only people that are America first. And then, yeah, I mean, go for it. Like, start families.
I've noticed the adverse is true amongst older millennials, right? They kind of get tied up in the circle of coomers, where it's just guys who want to go out, be belligerent alcoholics, and chase tail every night. So you're right. If you establish a good network, don't get caught up in the bad, because there's plenty of it in the workplace and in colleges.
Yeah, you should always be like, you know, running bet pools on who can go the longest without cooming, you know, or playing board games together or gaming together, you know, hanging out in person, doing whatever you can to be around each other, because you'll socialize each other in a sense. And, you know, like the service that I provide, or, you know, when people come by my YouTube channel, I talk about these deeply personal things. And people feel so soothed and they feel so refreshed from my company, in a sense. But if you go ahead and just provide even 20% of that to each other, you know, you stay sober when you hang out, you don't drink, you don't become degenerate, you just hang out or you talk online, then you start to feel like soothed. You start to feel like like not a doomer, you know. You don't feel like so black-pilled, because at least there's some people out there that get it. You start to feel that warmth, and I think that warmth makes you feel existentially secure. And that's what we need from our Groyper army. It's like, we know we're going to win. We know we have the better arguments. We know we're going to defeat our enemies. But it comes from coming together. It doesn't come from like, you know, it doesn't come from any of the guys that I said to gatekeep. Like, it comes from love, and it comes from Christ.
Absolutely, and that's really what we're trying to do here at the Groypcast and the Daily Groyper. And one of the things you mentioned was, you know, gatekeeping out these simps and coomers. I think that leads perfectly into our next section, which is Simp of the Week. So, Charlie, you got those screen caps and the video ready?
Yeah. I just had one quick question for Steve. There's probably a lot of people that are new to your content, and one of the videos that probably came out a month or so ago was a lot about Stefan Molyneux and giving him a lot of feedback.
Oh, right.
And I was just curious, what was the history that you guys had previous to that whole deal?
You know, Stefan has mostly kept me at arm's length for a very long time. I've known him maybe 10 years now. 10 years ago, I started writing him emails every now and then. Now, the people that I was like good friends with, they were much more involved with him. He was like going to their apartment and stuff like this back in the day and having group calls with them privately and stuff like that. And that didn't work out for them so much. And so I saw that sort of like play out right in front of me. And it just gave me some more personal perspective on Stefan, some of his interpersonal difficulties that you don't get on the podcast, you don't get from his content online. And then I saw some of this stuff in like the books he was writing. Real-time relationships is one that I've really taken to task.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've had this long-standing experience of Stefan, but you know, I would never, I would never condemn the guy, because the guy has just done so much good that he basically is like a made man. You know, if you think about it in terms of the mob, like here's another thing, you know, and I don't want to speak for Nick, so I'm not speaking for Nick when I say this, but Nick said, hey, guys, sort of lay off the people that were our allies, or at least kind of came to our defense during the Groyper Wars, like lay off them a little bit. Cernovich is one of these people. And Cernovich is a made guy. And I don't think that a lot of people understand this. I don't, because, you know, he says stuff that people are like, oh, this is cringe, you know, and I get that. But what people need to understand about Cernovich is that he unseated a sitting congressman. And, you know, that makes you relevant for like 8 years. That buys you like 8 to 10 years of relevance just automatically. Mm-hmm. And so this guy, in a sense, he's a bit of a made guy. And he has like so much clout with the right people, by the way, because it is a people thing. You know, some of this political stuff is a bit of a people thing.
And money, too.
And money. That it's like he's baiting you. He's baiting you. I think he's kind of devious about it. I think he sees some of it as like, how do I whip these guys into shape? But I think some of it is to virtue signal, or to look well in front of other people. Because he has said some things in the past that have been compromising to his current political position. And so when people go at him hard, it's like, look, A, he's a made guy. B, he spoke up in defense of the Groypers in some ways. You know, it's like, it's not perfect. It's in a Cernovich way. You know, it's like the weird Mike way. And then the other thing is that we need to be ruthlessly fighting our enemies. And our enemies are within our ranks. They're called Conservative Inc. You know, crossing that bridge with Cerno, it's like, he's not in the way of mass migration. He's not going to stand in the way of that. He's not going to disrupt that. And so that's kind of how I see Molyneux too. It's like Molyneux would totally go for curbing mass migration, you know, by legal means. I know he says he's an ANCAP, but the week just before Trump got elected, he said, oh, what the hell? I'm just going to come out and say it. I'm for Trump. You know, so that's a statist position there. You know, maybe it's a little bit of pearl-clutching because he's a Canadian citizen and he didn't have to vote in the American election. But he did make that statement. So it's like you can reasonably infer that this guy would support the curbing of mass legal migration. And so, yeah, I went in on him a little bit in these videos because I get tired of the theatricality. I get tired of the like talking in terms of this conversation is on the brink of decimation by the powers that be. And you know, when he's actually had a very robust financial structure for a long time, I get tired of that stuff. But overall, you know, I think he's a net positive, and I think it was really unfortunate that he unfollowed Nick when he did. And I wonder if Stefan is a bit you know, over the hill a little bit. Like, he's not quite having the impact intellectually that he was even, you know, a few years ago. I wonder that. I wonder it aloud. I don't want to be like holding on to these thoughts. But I don't think he's going to be a disrupting force on America First. And if anything, he'll sort of do this thing that he does with Imam Tawhidi, where he just kind of like retweets the imam every now and then. And that like leaves him feeling good about it. So, yeah, I think that's the direction it'll go. And honestly, tacit support or even like semi-explicit support, I think is enough. I don't think we need to be like putting people to purity tests. I don't feel like I was with that. I feel like I was sort of given a lifeline to a lot of guys that have been frustrated with Molyneux for a while, and just give them my own perspective, because I don't want to sit on things. I don't want to like keep things on my chest, because, you know, that can sour you and that can make you bitter.
But guys who are,
you know, even one foot in the door, I think that's good enough. You know, like with Cerno, he's kind of like one foot in the door, and that's honestly, that's enough. I mean, we just, this, because America First has universal appeal. And so if some people are reluctant or quite frankly, they're a little insolent about getting with America First, it's like, let's have patience with them, because, you know, we need all the hitters we can get. And America is in really dire straits right now. And I think Groypers are the only people that really get the severity of it. I mean, like, it's so bad. It's, everything is like shopping world mall. You know, it's like everything's DMV clown world right now. It's terrible. It is so terrible. It is so, you guys think of like Christopher Cantwell freaking out because he can't handle the heat on him. I mean, you think of that degree of sensitivity, like freaking out and Fed posting and like getting involved with the FBI. Like, it induces psychosis in people. Like, if we had a calm, even classical liberal 1800s, you know, Taftian, Howard Taft sort of society, like a lot of people that have flipped their gourds in the last 5 years wouldn't have, because this situation is so psychosis inducing. It is so crazy what mass migration does to the social fabric. And then this cultural Marxism attack on God, you know, it's left people in a really, really dire situation. And so we need all the hitters we can get. Anyone who can muster some punching power out of this, it's like, man, we could use you, because there's not, we don't got a lot of soldiers left. You know, we cleaned them all out in the world wars. And then, you know, Marxism swept over and knocked over the rest of them. So we need all the hitters we can get. So that's how I see Stefan. That's what I think about with those guys. And, you know, I do wish them the very best. My idea of what the very best is a little bit different than theirs, but I think we're all pointed in the same general direction.
Yeah, I agree.
I might agree. I actually agree with, like, the Stefan Molyneux point, but someone like Cernovich, I just generally don't trust. And I'm not sure if I would want to, if my ideal society is really anywhere close to Cernovich's. He's anti-Christian. I mean, he counter-signals Christians all the time. He criticizes
especially Catholics.
Yeah, especially Catholics. So that's not really promoting God in society. And you look, like, should we not fight back when Cernovich, say, goes after Jake Lloyd? And the thing is, you look at Jake Lloyd has far fewer Twitter followers, yet just over doubled, like, the likes, completely ratioed Cernovich. Like, yeah. How much patience should we give to these people who are becoming increasingly irrelevant and continue to counter-signal us?
Well, the thing is, these people are extremely competent people that have a lot of in-person connections and a lot of ability to pull together with wherewithal. They possess wherewithal to make things happen and make things happen for themselves. And so when we're talking about professional competencies, I mean, we're not looking at this through the arguments, because, yeah, on the arguments, it's like Cerno gets blown out, you know, like fairly often, you know, and I understand why some people don't trust him. And you know, I don't follow him on Twitter, and, you know, I'm not trying to be his friend or anything, but he is an extremely competent person. He's a trained lawyer. He was in the military. I'm not sure which one. And he has connections up the wazoo. And that makes him a professional presence. And so, yeah, if we look at things through the arguments, I mean, gosh, you know, you could toast them all day, or you could toast whoever, because most people don't, they don't want to go that far into the argument. So they don't want to sort of piece apart the argumentation and understand things, because they frankly don't have that kind of time, like people that are extremely online and Zoomers that are coming up right now. But we do, there is a bit of like professional infrastructure there that is worth thinking about. And like people wanted to go in on Don Jr. I'm like, don't go in on Don Jr. This guy is massively, massively competent. You know, we look at him, he's like, he's throwing his hands up on The View and he's saying, oh, you all are triggered. And, you know, we think this is kind of like a ham, kind of a hammy time. But, you know, this guy was retweeting Molyneux's stuff right around when Molyneux was talking about demographics, you know, 2.5 years ago or whatever, when he's doing this truth about Ted Cruz and truth about that, you know, what was ever, whatever was in the news cycle. Don Jr. was retweeting this guy around that time. So he's exposed to stuff around that time. This guy is like a vice president of a huge company. So, you know, we can work with people in that regard. Or we can just roast them on the arguments, roast, beat them. It's like, I think we need to beat Ben Shapiro. I think we need to beat Michael Knowles. I think we need to beat Matt Walsh and Charlie Kirk. You know, you'll notice that Candace Owens has like really stayed out of this fight. And that's because she is a savvy professional operator. Now, when she starts to argue, it's like, oh, God, you know, you're just like, oh, you know, you hit her on the black crime statistics and stuff like this. And she just gets blown out there. But she is a savvy, savvy, competent, professional person. And I don't want to say we're going to business our way to freedom or, you know, order or whatever like this. But it is a component worth considering.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Like, we definitely need people who are very good at politicking. And I think Candace Owens, you know, as much as I don't like her politics, she went from like no name to household name in a year. That's like great self-promotion and marketing skills right there.
Yeah.
I think unless anyone else has something to add, we can probably just move on to the simple.
I just wanted to say that the reason why I brought up that question in the first place was because I ran across that video not knowing the history. And so I kind of dug through the lore a little bit. But it was fascinating to find out sort of all that stuff, because I ran into your YouTube account probably about 6 months ago or so. And that's really when I got all this content. And I think that there's a lot of other people that probably ran into you probably around when that Ashley St. Clair photo showed up, too. Mm-hmm. You probably got a lot more people following you, too. So it was really interesting to find out all that stuff. But yeah, I think that there is, with specific people, there is a level of tolerance that we need to have, because there are bigger fish to fry. And I think that that's the main takeaway there.
Oh yeah. And there's also a degree of confidence that I think we should take out of having the better arguments and the superior political positions. It's like, we kind of want to entice people to come under our banner, even if they are big fish. You know, I don't know. I'd like to think I'm a bit of a, like a hope bringer or something like this, you know, like I don't need to, you know, people get really edgy about the World War II stuff and it puts everyone on edge. And, you know, I kind of just want to calm everyone down. like if I can calm Donald Trump down a little bit, you know, to get him to hit Congress on immigration a little bit, or even if I could get Dan Crenshaw to calm down a little bit, then I think that would be a little bit more useful. We'll see. I mean, everyone has their own fighting style, but I do think we can take a lot of heart and a lot of confidence out of having the better arguments.
Yes, and I think you'll be good at calming people. I see a lot of love in the chat saying they have a very calming, soothing voice.
Yeah.
All right, Charlie, you got the videos and screen caps queued up?
Yep, we're going to run the new intro for Simp of the Week.
Epic.
Here we go.
Boy, digging myself out the grave. Smoking my business haze. Maggots and worms in my brain. Gotta get out of this cage. Digging myself out of grave. Smoking my vision is haze. Maggots some words in my brain. Gotta get out of this case.
And here we are, our simp of the week, Christian O'Brien. And let's go ahead and look at these things first of all. So Christian has a little bit of a history, you could say, of being a simp. And he goes, hey, this is female Joker, you know, and this is basically about some girl, she's posing on a beach, a whore.
Yeah.
And she's talking about 4 weeks ago to the day I found out my dad died. 5 days ago, I found out that he committed suicide. I am sexy and sexual and grief-stricken and shrewd and zany and romantic and generous and imaginative and manipulative and reckless and ambitious and good. I have generalized anxiety disorder. Who knew, right? And chronic depression, and I used to be addicted to Adderall. I'm fantastic with words, and I refuse to let the world force me into being any smaller than the messy whole of who I am just because of some parts of me seem confusing or something.
She's definitely a whole, that's for sure.
Wow.
And then there's the second picture that says, and this is her basically just wearing a man's sweater that says, also, do you like my sweater? It was my father's and he committed suicide. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of eyes in suicide. And so Cobb says, oh, no, guys, we can't hate on her. This is just the female Joker. Steve's making sounds.
in his own replies, he tags two e-girls, Sydney and Nina, just like these professional e-girls who just take selfies of themselves and shit like that. And then I reply, I just say, you literally can't stop simping, Lamau. He's like, oh, I can't. This is like cope. This is just what simps do. They like try to ironically be like, yeah, I'm simping, but it's fun. It's ironic. And then I challenged him publicly to a debate on the Colpi situation because he was a big defender of Colpi. I'm not sure if we have those screen caps, but if we do, let's bring them up in a minute. And so he responded to my challenge, and he's like, 197 followers, Lamau, shut the fuck up. Which is very funny because another contributor to the Daily Groyper who has more followers than him then said, well, debate me then. And of course, he backed down. And then, Steve, I want to get your analysis right here. I know you're a big believer in physiognomy. You do a lot of physiognomy checks in your analyses. What do you think about Mr. Cobb here, Mr. Christian O'Brien?
No, man. Well, instantly I see he's got like Coomer face. This is the thing. It's like people don't realize that when you jerk off, it slowly changes. It like sculpts your face. I don't know if people realize this, but you can always tell when someone has Coomer face. Because there's a tension that comes into the face. Yeah, and everyone's posting the Coomer face in the chat, and they're absolutely right to do that. If you'll see the sort of parallels here between the Coomer face and this Cobb guy, notice the lines in the face. Notice the tension. Notice the pulled up sort of dimply smile. This is like a cope smile.
Insecure.
Like, yeah, insecure. There's like a gaping hole in my soul because I rotted out my gray matter in my brain from jerking off too much. And then I notice he's got zits on his forehead. I'm wondering what kind of diet he's... I wonder about his gut biome. It's probably pretty bad. I know a lot of guys... they complain when they jerk off too much that they get stomach aches. And so I don't know what the science is there, but I'm sure that jerking off screws with your gut biome and leaves you unable to process foods as well. So he's got a bit of acne going. This sweater that he's wearing under the blazer, I mean, is that like late 90s Goodwill? I think that's the last time I saw something like that. This article of clothing with the, I don't know what it is. I mean, it just looks like an old man shirt. But anyway, those are some initial impressions. And I noticed that he's got like the $24 Bluetooth earbud set going. So, you know, he's a person that is like committing. Maybe these are secondhand clothes as well. But he's sort of committed to being thrifty, and we can see shades of white knight in his choice of apparel and digital attire. So that's kind of like my initial impressions of this guy.
I think, too, we need to point out the eyes real quick.
Quickly on the diet, though, he said, "I've been sticking to liquor pretty effectively because beer had been chonking me a little."
Oh no. But let's look at these eyes, these dark, baggy eyes with a horrible canthal tilt. If you don't know what a canthal tilt is, Google that. It's like the digit ratio for your face.
Oh wow, okay.
It's like really bad canthal tilt. Saggy eye. Look at him. He has pain. He's pained right here.
Yeah.
He does not like his existence. It's very sad. But do we have any more screen caps?
Someone in the chat says 10,000 Coom stare.
Yeah,
totally, dude. Definitely. Totally. and his name is Soul Coughing. I mean, that's like this guy's soul is coughing. It's very true.
His eyes want to cry, but he's smiling.
Yeah,
he's a very conflicted man.
Let's see if we can do this on stream. Cover up the mouth. Just like have only the top part of the face visible, not the mouth.
Okay, hang on.
Just the eyes. Let's zoom in on just the eyes right here.
We can do that. Just takes a second for me to enlarge this photo. Oh, you'll be able
to see
that. Put
a skull mask on him.
See the acne a lot better now, too. Here it comes.
Okay. Everyone wait for it.
There's always this lovely little delay.
Yeah, slight delay, but... Oh, no!
Oh, boy.
That is not a smiling man. This is not registered to me as a smiling man.
I mean, from this angle, he just looks like a jihadist or something. That's terrible.
Oh, this is sad. This is
what exactly has this man seen? What is he looking at, too?
He's looking at e-girls' timelines where they're talking about, like, having sex with black men. That's what he's looking at right now. This is him finding out Colpi as a black boy.
He's scouring the PayPig hashtag.
Have you heard about this?
I think I see Pornhub in his eyes.
Have you seen any of this PayPig business that our friend Charlotte has been pulling?
I just heard about it. I think it's brilliant. I mean, I think however you can like hook the enemy into whatever you're doing, like a sitting congressman talked about Nick Fuentes. You know, he's still shooting across the bow tonight. You know, he put out a video. I think any way you can pull or sucker people into your whole screed, your digital war making, then you got to go for it.
Yeah, it's been pretty sad to see the types of women. I mean, 18, 19, 20 year olds just resorting to this as an outlet for money. It's almost like you've given up already. I don't know if it's a form of validation, or for example, I guess more like an Instagram model or getting that high off that kind of dopamine from a female perspective. But validation from Coomers online seems to be pretty low bar.
Yeah. Well, there's two sides of it. It's like their dads, their Gen X dads were perverts and simps. And so their dads failed them. They had weak dads. And so they want to get revenge on their dads. And so they want to like make new simps because that's what they're sort of acclimatized to. But then the underside of it is that they're wanting to be rescued. I mean, they want some guy to actually care about them for once in their lives. And that's the really sad part. But so long as they got those things out, I mean, so long they got their chess monkeys out or whatever you want to call them, then they're weaponized. And so like patrolling e-girls is really relevant. You have to sort of neutralize the situation before any progress can be made. That's why seeing this stuff, I don't know where things are at with Brittany Venti now, but seeing that she was like willing to put him away for a little bit and like wear sweaters, that started to neutralize the situation. And that brings her closer to God. It brings her closer to a traditional existence. And that gets a lot of this crazy rescue and revenge stuff out of there so that she can just deal with grown men plainly. So I don't know. When I see these girls, I always remember that they want to get revenge on their shitty fathers, but then they also want to be rescued by their shitty fathers. And so they have to create other simps in the world.
Absolutely. Do we have any more screen caps for the simp of the week, or is that it?
I have this article from the Daily Groyper I'm pulling up right here.
Fantastic. I think I know who wrote that article.
Yeah, I think it was made by Mountain Man.
Sweet.
If we know who Mountain Man is. Maybe Anita Bloom. I'm not sure. One of the two. But this is... I'll read off these really quick, even though you can see them. This is from the Paying Toll Culpy. And here, this is what she says. And here he tells me he'd been cheating once a month for the year and a half we've been together. I miss him, or the him I thought he was. That's an interesting point. I just want to talk to him about it. I think I'll need someone to kind of make sure I don't hang out with him or see him. Maybe my dad will ensure. Yikes. He knows he saw me running downstairs crying and yelling. No, the girl he slept with were all trans.
this is the e-girl that Cobb, the Christian O'Brien simp of the week, was simping after. He was telling everyone to lay off this girl. You know, she had made fun, and there are more screen caps in this article where she was calling people who like criticize interracial relationships, you know, incels and racist. And I just wish you were less racist. And I feel like this is just a big, you know, vindication for some more controversial things that our side, the Groypers, the Zoomers, the gamers have been saying.
Right. Yeah, I mean, gosh, that's really sad. It is Vindication Nation. And I mean, someone's got to tell these, you know, whenever you run into a girl, you got to basically like convey to her that, hey, if we're genetically proximal, then I'm going to take better care of you than the outgroup will. So we're, in a sense, we're kind of like brothers and sisters in a way. You know, blacks talk about each other in this way. They're always all my brother and my sister. And this thing that Kanye is doing is like way black race woke. He's like probably a black identitarian almost at this point. But I mean, we want to convey that to these girls. But again, when they're weaponized, we just got to fight them. I mean, when they're going full e-girl, like that's weaponization, and you just have to neutralize the e-girl.
Neutralize the e-girl. I like that. I think that should be the new catchphrase of the Groypcast. Neutralizing e-girls. But
I was going to read some of the other tweets that are in here.
Yeah.
We have one girl named Raven. She's basically saying something about how you should be a coomer, otherwise you're unhealthy. And then Culpy replies, it seems unreasonable when someone is so used to it. But trust me, once you break free from that vice, it is so much better. My BF did it on his own. I did not force him. And he's very, very happy he did. So this is a couple of weeks back. So this is just showing sort of where the relationship was at and her sort of her lenses that she is viewing the relationship through. Meanwhile, this guy is sleeping with trans people.
Yeah, very, very unfortunate. But I think we've had enough. I think we had enough of disgusting e-girl tweets for now, and e-girl stories. I think we'll just segue on to maybe, you know, Steve's final thoughts, the books that he has out, website, anything else you want to kind of like shill, promote.
Oh, sure. Yeah. You know, I'm happy to go another 15 minutes or whatever. We got a pretty good viewer count right now. You know, I don't want to bend anybody's arm behind their back or whatever.
No, you can stay on if you want. You can stay on for like next section too. We're just going to go into some news stories.
I had a quick question too, Steve, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
Go ahead.
I think one of the things you brought up was good, you know, for young Zoomers and people maybe are feeling a little black-pilled or whatever. Your idea of journaling to self-knowledge, like how can they make sure they stay on that every day? You know, how do you not get complacent?
All right. Well, you know, I don't know where I picked this idea up from. I think it's this guy that wrote this old Chinese text. Anyway, he talked about chopping wood, and chopping wood is a daily practice. You know, in order to prepare for winter, you got to chop wood to have wood stacked up on your deck or whatever so that you can bring it in and put it in your stove and keep yourself warm in the winter. You need to have a daily practice that improves you. I think that's where I got where I am. I mean, when I was 19, I had to get, this is crazy, and I don't think I've ever said this on the internet before, but it's just been fresh in my head because I've been really comparing. When I was 19, and that was 14 years ago, I was so anxious and I was so stressed out, but really it was anxiety, that I would get cold sweats. And my cold sweats were so bad and it was so humiliating for me that I would like sweat through shirts. And so I had to get like medically prescribed sweat blocker, you know, and that's when I was like, damn, this is too much. I don't know what's going on with me, but I know that if I go into the medical industrial complex with this was my thought at the time, that this is not going to pan out for me. So I need to figure out what the hell's going on. I realized, well, I'm anxious all the time. And so I dealt with that, you know, and now I'm cool as a cucumber. Took me some years. But I did that daily practice. You know, some guys do meditation. I think praying to God is a really, really great thing. I think journaling, putting pen to paper or typing things out on notepad and, you know, on your computer. Some kind of daily practice where you practice some self-awareness. I mean, it's done wonders for me. It's put me with the greatest company, with like the best people on the internet, you know, yourselves included. Like I'm in an alliance, and that's because I have earned my due. That's because I have eaten shit for years in order to just like program myself in a lot of ways to be a more functional, social, you know, winning sort of dude, you know, to be a better fighter in all this. You got to train. And so, yeah, this idea of journaling for self-knowledge, you know, some of my older back catalog in terms of my books and even my videos on YouTube, just talk about things to this effect. You know, it's even in my newer stuff, but it was definitely like a big deal before. And I've always chopped wood. And I think that's, if someone wants to take something away from this video, it's that we need to neutralize the e-girls and we need to chop wood and never coom. I want to say this thing real quickly, because it was in the screenshot. This mulatto girl talking to Colpi or whatever. There's this huge misnomer that you're supposed to ejaculate every 2 weeks. You know, that's what the doctors say. Oh, well, you know, it's been found that you'll start to hurt your prostate if you don't ejaculate every couple weeks. Da, 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 da. Stupid boomer talking point. I mean, never fall prey to that, because the longer you hold it in, bro, like the longer you build up your chakras or whatever you want to call it with your based energy, I mean, the things that you can do, you know, you become bulletproof in a sense. And so, and that's part of the daily practice. And I think this is a huge thing to bring up tonight, the last night of No Nut November. I mean, I came in explicitly wanting to talk about this because this is the last night of No Nut November. And anybody who's trying to make it over the line tonight, I mean, I really feel for my kings out there. And anybody who made it for this November, big hats off to you. And anyone who had the courage to post the Coomer Avi on Twitter when they coomed this month, I mean, my hats off to those guys as well. We need to really help each other on this thing because porn wrecks civilizations, and it's deliberately been that way for a very long time. And so not cooming, having some self-awareness every single day, in some circles traditionally it's called mindfulness, and then I just call it chopping wood. That's really going to improve your guys' lives really fast, you know. And I've been doing this forever. Like, I'm like 15 years into this shit, and my life is lit. My life is awesome. I just wrote a book in 6 weeks, and the book that I'm working on right now, it's almost done, and I'm only 4 weeks in, and this stuff is just flowing. I mean, and I'm not cooming or anything like that. I'm, you know, I'm being straight-laced like that. And so what I'm able to do right now, you guys see me online everywhere. Like, I'm extremely online. But, you know, I'm also making money, and I'm, like, talking to people behind the scenes. I'm doing all this cool stuff. And I'm going to go to CPAC in 2020. I have this by the grace of God, by the grace of my daily effort, by chopping wood. It's the only reason I have any of this, man. I got, like, my own house in Montana. One of the most sought after states in the union. I mean, I have all this by the grace of God, by my humility to just submit myself, even if it smashes me to smithereens, to submit myself to the methodology of just learning what's true and knowing what's true and having the courage to face it and having the courage to cut out from myself whatever isn't true. You know, in the Bible, it says, something like this. I'm not very good with lyrics or with quotes, but it says, if your left hand causes you to sin against me, cut it off with your right, something to this effect. And it's absolutely true. You've got to just do the right thing. And if you do the right thing, your life is going to be amazing.
Absolutely. Great thoughts. I do want to say too, not just no, not November. You know, November, funny alliteration, funny month. No nut life. Don't just get over it. Don't just be like, tomorrow, oh man, I can't wait to be a coomer again. Go as long as you can. Pray for the willpower. No nut December. No nut 2020. No nut life.
Yes. No nut 2020. No nut life. I love that. That's so good.
Yeah, and if you want more to know more about that, you can check out the GroypCast interview with E. Michael Jones. We talk a lot about that.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, he knows it's a tool for political control. I mean,
absolutely. I have libido dominandi like right in front of me right here. Yeah. Nice. So let's move on to the news section, unless you're squeezed for time and you want to sign off.
Let's do another 10 minutes. Yeah,
I can. Another 10 minutes. Epic. So I think we have ZoomerNet here. Welcome, ZoomerNet.
What's going on, guys? How's it going, Steve?
Hey, ZoomerNet.
Steve, I just wanted to ask you real quick about your new book. If you wanted to share any details of what that's about and kind of how you came to writing it.
Yeah, the newest book, the one I'm working on right now, I'm kind of split on what I'm going to call it, but I think I'll probably call it Forever Punished, because that's just what it feels like to live in America right now. I was going to call it 8 a.m. Chainsaw Landscaping. You know, if you think about that, like waking up at 8 a.m. Because in American cities, fucking Mexicans are everywhere, you know, doing this cheap labor. And they're waking everybody up in the neighborhood, and they're doing weed whackers. And, you know, Delicious Taco tweets out this thing about these guys are chainsaw landscaping at 8 o'clock in the morning. Build the wall. You know, that's what he says. And that's the feel of this book. That's the vibe. Torturing the Villagers was all about, like, you know, when you run around in a video game and you just kill all the NPCs, you just go like full psychopath. I don't know if any of you guys have done that. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's, you know, it's like a fun thing that, you know, or you're like torturing the Sims or whatever, you know, I love that feel, you know, I love that vibe. And that's kind of what it feels like as one of us. Like a groiper, that's what regular society feels like. It feels like you always want to drive 90 miles an hour, but no one lets you, and everyone forces you to drive 45 miles an hour. I mean, that was the schmood of Torturing the Villagers. But this new book is a little bit more like just the forever punishment of living around strangers. I mean, that's more the mood of this book, and I'll probably have it out before Christmas. So so you guys can like get it for your friends and your family or whatever.
Awesome. We'll keep a lookout for that. And also I see in the chat, people are wanting a link to torturing the villagers. If one of our mods could put the Amazon
just posted
link.
It.
Okay. You just said fantastic. Yep.
Thanks.
Awesome. So I think it's news time. We're going to talk about what's on the docket, the London Bridge attack.
Ah, yes. We have the recent London terror attack. So for anyone who has been kind of checked out of the news lately, basically there was this man in his late 20s. You may be able to guess the ethnicity. He was previously jailed for plotting terror attacks. I think he went to jail in 2012. But he was let out. He was released early under a program called Learning Together. This was one of these kind of prison reform programs. It kind of sounds similar to like the First Step Act, in which the kind of the head of the Justice Department over there in the UK decided it would be a great idea to just start letting all these ex-terrorists out of jail. So halfway through his 16-year sentence, he was released, and several people say that he was radicalized even further while inside prison. And basically, he went out, and he went on a stabbing spree on the London Bridge. And it was interesting because they showed videos of the police who were just totally cucked trying to tackle him. Eventually they shot him, but at first it was just like typical London, you know, just no balls police. And it was actually interesting. One of the people who assisted was someone who had killed someone previously. So it's just a pretty much overall kind of crazy story. And it just kind of seems like one of these typical terror attacks that's going on in Europe that's just going to continue increasing in frequency, and they just refuse to acknowledge the problem. Steve, do you have any thoughts on this whole thing?
Well, I thought it was really cool that a Polish guy grabbed a narwhal tusk off of some pub or something, pub wall, and then like went to save everyone. I mean, it just shows you like the Poles are pretty based, and the Brits have their heads up their own asses still. And you know, it's so bad and it's so ugly over there what they're doing in the education system. And now there's all these private Sharia courts everywhere. There's like a shroud descending upon the UK, and it breaks my heart because a lot of the people that had the biggest impact on me intellectually were Anglos. And now to see just how toothless they become, I mean, you know, I just wish the best for them, and I'm always thinking about them. And so I think it's awful. And I think that anybody that doesn't feel fury in the face of this conquest, you know, should really self-reflect.
I think it's also kind of crazy how one of the guys he killed, this guy named Jack Merritt, he was 25, I think. And he was actually, they pulled up his Twitter, because I guess that's what everyone does now when someone gets killed. And they looked through his Twitter, and he was actually, you know, one of these kind of globalist people who was advocating for the refugees and saying that, you know, they need to be more accepting. They need to take these people in. And he ended up getting killed. So it's just, it's kind of crazy how, I mean, there have been a few other stories like this, how these people just don't realize what they're doing. And it just even impacts them personally. It just turns out to be destructive.
Yeah, they've had their whole amygdala obliterated. Like, this guy had no sense of, you know, unsafety or danger. He didn't have a sense of danger. And so you live by the paws, you die by the paws. And I think some people are like cackling, like, haha, you look at you, you know. But I look at this guy, and he's a handsome guy. I mean, he's an Aryan super soldier. he's just loaded up with the wrong software.
Yes.
And so, you know, we need to reach our kings. Like, we need to reach these guys. We need to confront as many people as we can, because our ideas come very naturally. Our ideas are with the natural order. And so this guy would have been a great groiper. You know, it's like a man, it's a man down in a sense.
Yeah, it's very upsetting. And it's just like, you see the reaction online, you see just kind of the same thing happening over and over again, where it's like, okay, when is something actually going to happen? Because, you know, you have the Twitter freak out, you have now this judge is under fire, because I guess this, this Jewish judge who was the, you know, the head of the justice, criminal justice over there, he just decided to go on a spree of freeing prior terrorists. But I mean, I guess maybe he'll face some backlash for that. But I'm just wondering, like, what is going to change? When is there going to be a breaking point? It seems like kind of how you mentioned before, just like this managed decline just keeps on going. And it's just pretty sad to see for them. I mean, luckily, you know, it's not going on as much over here, but it just seems like there's no end in sight for this kind of stuff in Europe.
Well, and London wasn't the only place. Yesterday, there was an attack in the Netherlands too, where two miners were stabbed. And I don't think the police found the guy yet. And that's just a recurring theme there. It was, you know, people holiday shopping. And a year ago in Amsterdam in the Netherlands, two Americans got stabbed at a shopping market. So like Steve said, these could be our guys getting stabbed, you know? It's not something to laugh at. It's not funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, Europe just needs to get shit together. Like, Europe's falling apart. With not obviously the whole of Europe. You know, Poland's good. Czechia is good, Slovakia is good, even though like Austria is good, Hungary's good, Romania, but like Western Europe, especially the UK, France, and Germany, the big three, and Sweden, are just like completely falling apart.
It's the countries that don't believe in demographics. Like, all of the countries that are doing well, they understand that they have to maintain, you know, what they have going now. They understand that you need strict borders and you can't let Islam get a foot in your country. And the ones that kind of give in and make, you know, they offer up, they kind of compromise. They're the ones who get screwed over. And I mean, it's just a lesson to the, you know, the V4 countries that are still holding out. But it's like, you need to hold your ground, can't budge, and you have to fight this as hard as possible. Otherwise, you know, it's just going to all go downhill.
Yeah, and it's also, too, like, the EU in general is really messing up Europe, because you look at Denmark, which is good policy-wise. Like, Denmark, they're actually fairly nationalist, fairly conservative, but they're flooded with migrants just because they're in the EU. They're trying their best to, like, get them out, but yeah, the smaller countries just can't really fight against the influence of the large countries.
Well, I think they've passed some I think Denmark has passed some laws like banning the burqa, and they've also tried to like increase the, you know, getting people out of there. They had a problem with, like, Turkish immigration. I guess there's a lot of Turks that go to Germany and Denmark. Like, you see these videos of them just, like, marching in the street. Like, you would think you were in Turkey. It's literally, like, a block full of people, and they all have the flag, and they're all, like, chanting in Arabic. And what they do is they just try to, like, I think this is already happening, they just try to form local parties and kind of consolidate power and to, you know, try to get their demands across. I mean, I don't see how any of them can realize, like, it's not going to work out. Like, they're not going to assimilate. They're going to try to, you know, gain power for themselves. And then you're going to be sitting there wondering what happened to your country. So I think it's a good lesson to learn from. I feel like kind of the worse it gets, the more people will catch on to it. But at the same time, it's like, all right, but how bad are we going to let it get? So I don't know. It's a dilemma.
Well, the mayor of London said, I want to reassure Londoners and visitors there will be enhanced police patrols, including firearm teams, on the streets of London this weekend. And if you've ever been near any landmarks in London, it's already, like, guarded by militias, you know? Like, how much more can there be, really, if they're not going to do
anything?
Yeah, that
guy's a fucking idiot. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Like, it's just all lip service at this point.
Steve, any thoughts from you?
Well, you know, I think that it's important to, like, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And so people think I'm crazy when I'm out in public. They either think that I'm like an angel, you know, everyone, Steven, you're so sweet and we love you. And then they find out my politics and then they see me as Lucifer, you know, or people think that I'm a little pushy and a little confrontational. A little terse, a little irritable. And that's because I really think that confrontation is so critical. It's so critical that we have softer confrontations now so that we don't have to have hard confrontations like what the UK is going through right now. I mean, it's going to be a bloodbath over there because there's not many strong men, and you know, everyone's getting nicked on microaggressions and put in prison for stuff like this. And in America, we are sort of the last bastion. We're the last place that you can be sort of terse with another person in public and give them a what's for, give them an earful, you know, honk your horn at them or whatever. And so, you know, you're going to have to, I think people are going to have to cultivate that a little bit when you're at the grocery store or wherever you're at. I think it's important to confront people and to put it in their heads. Now, of course, we want to do as much as we can over the internet and fight in the realm of concepts. But what are you doing with your personality that you aren't being terse with knuckleheads in public and third worlders at times when you can, when they won't mob you, you know, or call the police and like get the police on you? And, you know, it's like, take your shots when you can, because it's gonna do stuff to your personality. I'm not talking about fighting people. I'm just talking about asserting what's American and what's not, asserting what our values are, asserting that we're a Christian nation, asserting that whites were not so long ago pretty race woke. I mean, if you look back in the history books, the 1924 Immigration Act came off the heels of a lot of race wokeness. And so if you embody this kind of person when you're out in public, like sometimes I'll wear my cowboy hat out in public, you know, and I forget it's on my head, and then I'll go to like a liberal place and people will be like eyeing me, or I'll just be in a rush and I'll have a Trump shirt on because I was working out earlier. You know, the Trump campaign was nice. They gave me shirts because I worked their t-shirt booth once at a rally, and I had my Trump shirt on or my cowboy hat on or both at the same time. And I'm just in a liberal place and people start looking at me. And what do you think I'm doing? I'm going to fight back. I'm not going to be some goddamn cuck. I'm not going to be some fucking pussy and just take it from these people. You think I'm going to cower? You think I'm going to feel nervous? You think I'm going to feel scared? By golly, I am fire and brimstone. I am bringing back America first, and you all will bend the knee. I'm not going to bend the knee to the liberals. And so I'm going to give them a bit of grief when I'm out in public. Now, that doesn't mean I'm fighting with them. It just means that I'm asserting what America's about. And that's the way we used to treat each other, by the way. Americans used to have a bit more balls. They used to have a bit thicker skin. They used to tussle with each other. And it was like, dust yourself off. We'll be all right because we're all Americans. Now the people that are here, they're like lizards, and they're psychos, and they're zombies, and they're like enchilada, you know, sellers and stuff like this. And so just act like a goddamn man. Act like a goddamn man out in public sometimes. It's not going to kill you. Practice it. Try it out. It might give you an edge on the internet too. You know, these things have some crossover. So, I would rush in and I beat the living shit out of a terrorist. If a terrorist was hurting my people, was hurting Americans, I wouldn't hesitate. I wouldn't hesitate for a second. And neither should anybody else that's listening to this. We got to have courage. How are we going to take down Ben Shapiro if you're upset that someone's looking at you for your t-shirt and you feel insecure? Oh, I voted for Trump. I feel insecure about this. How are you going to take down Ben Shapiro? How are you going to beat up a guy with bitch titties if you have bigger bitch titties? You know? So that's something to think about. It's like, I'm not scared of a little Latina. I'm not scared of a loud black lady. Are you fucking kidding me? I'm not scared of some big black dude. Like, I'm a gamer, dude. I'm smart. I know what I'm doing.
I think I definitely agree with that. I feel like that's a major problem right now is this, like, I'm so glad that you brought that up, like, just the fearlessness of kind of defending your beliefs. Because a lot of this just, like, boils down to people, you know, like, trying to avoid confrontation and just backing down and, you know, minding their own business, especially if they're in an environment like a liberal area that's not so friendly. But I mean, I think a big part of it really just comes down to, like you said, just kind of, you know, growing some balls and conveying your opinion in public and, you know, accepting kind of the whatever social things that happen within reason. And, you know, not being afraid to respond to people. And I think that's something big. I think that, you know, during 2016, this was kind of like during the campaign, this happened a lot. You know, people started being less afraid to publicly say their beliefs and that they were Republican, but I feel like, and conservative, I feel like now it's kind of receded a little bit where you have like the status quo of conservative ink kind of taking over. And some of these, like, you know, Trump hardliner beliefs are now being pushed aside a little. But I feel like we have a good opportunity going into 2020 to kind of reemerge these America First ideals. And it's going to take a lot of people that are willing to make a stand and defend it in public and, you know, show up to events and stuff like that. So I'm definitely looking forward to it.
Yeah. Well, I'll say Owen Schroyer is like such a role model in this respect. I mean, Alex Jones is really good too. He's like riding around in armored trucks and stuff like this. I mean, he's amazing. He's mythic in this sense. But Owen Schroyer is a really, really good example of what I'm talking about. And all the shit that he's had, people try to pile onto him. I mean, anyway, I got to run, guys. My kid's up and I got to take care of my kid. But wanted to give you guys a little bit of the juice here at the end.
Yo, base.
Oh, absolutely. People are loving it. Do you, real quick, have anything you want to plug?
Buy my book, guys, Torturing the Villagers. And I got a new one out. I'll give it a nice finish, make it cozy for Christmas time. So if you want to get something for your family or one of your friends or something like this, I'll have that book out before Christmas. So other than that, catch me on Telegram and I'll be around, man. I'm in the alliance, you know. You know, I'm a general or I'm a lieutenant or whatever. I'm an officer. So I'll be around. You guys keep doing your brilliant work. Keep crushing it. And thanks for having me on.
Oh, thanks for coming on, Steve.
Thanks. God bless.
Should we read some donations?
Yeah, I'll go through. KVLTVR donated one diamond, said based Franssen. Rush Limbaugh Groyper also donated one diamond and said, Steve is so based. KVLTVR. Again,
I think you can call him Coulter.
Oh, it's just called, okay. Coulter.
Call him Colby.
Colby donated another diamond. Take my money. 2Fitty donated, like, I don't know, 2 lemons. Hans Sarpe donated 2 ice cream. Coulter donated another diamond and said, thanks, Mr. Franssen. Skippity donated 1 lemon. Neo Decepticon donated 1 lemon. Hans Sarpe donated another ice cream. Thank you very much.
Dak donated a diamond. He says, Trump is bringing back the bravado. Follow his lead. Yeah, I think he did bring some of it back. I think it's going to be interesting to see what he does next year, whether he kind of returns to that aggressiveness or falls into the status quo. But yeah, I agree.
Oh, big money wage. He says, don't read these poverty lemons. I'm sorry. If you have a ninjet or an ninjet,
you like big money wage. Thank you for the ninjet. I see him on the top of the contributors list.
We would be very gracious, and we would read the rich people.
Oh, ninjagini, not ninjet.
Yeah, a ninja would be nice. You know, I saw some ninjets getting thrown around on Jake's stream, and man, it kind of was like rubbing salt in the wound. But getting tons of donations now.
Fund our grift. Don't you love your grifter Americans?
We need to buy merch, bro. So we can grift merch.
Yeah, we gotta make merch. We got
a pair of bosses.
We got hoodies coming out soon. I'm gonna make a Patreon.
I'm gonna make it all fans. Coming.
One thing I wanted if you want to know, that spicy energy that Steve was talking about when you're out in public, it's very important that you do not coom, because that's where that energy comes from.
Oh, 100%. I was listening to a lot of what he was saying with that, and it's so true. Just from, like, this month is always a reminder of that. It's like he was saying, just, like, fuck whatever the doctor says about prostate cancer. Like, I doubt that's true, and this is worth it anyways.
Coomers get prostate cancer.
If you don't get
Panther Den with two diamonds, thank you.
If you do get prostate cancer, what will happen is, like, you've already built up so much strength and energy for not cooming, you'll just beat it immediately. Like, you don't even need treatment. You'll just win. You'll beat it.
And coomers get prostate cancer, so that's bullshit.
Being a coomer is worse than having cancer.
I mean, yeah, it depends. But if you're old and you were a coomer your whole life, but now you're like 80 and you avoid having cancer, it's like, well, what are you doing with your life? You might as well have had the cancer.
Tough break.
Yeah. Dak says, with the diamond, he says, Trump will get more ballsy if he wins again. Yeah, I agree. I kind of want to see him just like go off the wall if he wins. Just like go crazy. That'd be pretty epic.
Birthright citizenship. That's the one.
Yeah. Dak also, another diamond, says, get married, have kids, porn falls away. True. Very true. Bird Bra donated one diamond, says, I'm at Zilla on Twitter. Birdie nationalism now. I assume that it is one of the many accounts of Kathy Zhu,
which are hilarious.
Yes, sir.
Oh, that was great. I don't know if we talked about that whole saga of Zoo.
That's like, I know, I almost feel like we need a special video report for that.
Yeah, I mean, it was just, I played along for like half of a day, but just like the funniest part, it was just her reaction. And, you know, I got some interesting information from an old friend of hers, let's say.
Do you want to tease some of that, maybe regarding some steppers?
Yeah. So apparently there are feet pictures out there. She used to sell feet pictures. I am currently trying to track them down so I can leak them to everyone. you know, not for me. Just so I can, you know, put them out. And apparently also, she is a Chinese nationalist. That's one of the reasons she's getting so offended over all this, you know, anti-immigration stuff. It's why she's friendly towards Yang. It's why she just retweeted a Chinese propaganda account on Twitter yesterday, I think, or earlier today. And apparently she's basically a liberal who just wants to support Trump because she thinks it's cool. This is coming from a guy who actually worked with her in 2016 for the Trump campaign. It was the Chinese Americans for Trump. And so we got a lot of good info on that. We'll probably put out an article.
It was just a source, but Big Money Wagey, being big money and being a wagey, donated not one but two Ninjaginis. Thank you so much, big guy.
Thank you.
Wow, huge shout out.
I think we got enough Ninjaginis for the whole crew now.
T for none with the diamond. Thanks, my guy.
Yeah, and send me those feet pics, you know, just for research.
Oh, I will. I'll let you analyze them.
It's kind of funny. We were just talking about don't coom, never coom. Also, we're trying to track down this Asian chick's feet pic.
Yeah. Hey, Alex Jones is right. These chai coms coming to take over our government, you know?
The CQ.
The chai com dragon.
Broke, JQ, woke, CQ.
Yeah, it really is.
Well, do we have any other topics we need to cover, or are we signing out?
I don't know. We should have a new website soon. I gotta check on that again.
Keep your eyes out for the new website. Whenever that, I don't fucking know what's gonna happen. Yep. I feel like saying, I'll keep your eyes out for the website for like a month now.
It'll happen before 2020.
I posted up a picture of Fentanyl the Shycom Dragon. If you are still unaware of who this character is, you're missing out. You can go on YouTube. You can find it all. Just enjoy this. This is Hallmark Alex Jones material.
That is a great video.
There's a lot of them, too. There's not just one.
Whoa! Big Money Wagey! Two more Ninjaginis!
We love you.
Yo, thank you, Big Money Wagey.
We love you.
We love you.
Thank you, Big Money.
We love you. You are a pay pig, and we love you.
Zoomer Historian says he donated a diamond. Where it at? Are we missing any?
It might be way up in the chat.
Yeah. Well, either way, shout him out. We shout him out.
Yeah, we shout him out. Let's see. Dak with the diamond says, "Big Money Wagey, quit flexing." Bro, he doesn't know how to quit flexing. He's in a permanent flex. I mean,
don't counter signal, Big Money Wagey.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are you trying to do to our bag, man?
We got to pay our bosses.
Yeah, we need these kind of pillars of support for the daily grifter, you know? He's a key player in our operation here.
Yeet Daddy with the diamond emoji. I don't think that counts.
Yeah, let's actually just continue having the show as these keep rolling in, as the money and the donations. We'll stop whenever they stop. I'll just keep shouting that. one lemon. What is this? Dak, making us look bad, bruh. Donates one diamond, I guess, in reference to Big Money Wagey. Panther Dan, one diamond. Ju calling us inches. What?
I think she meant incels.
Incels. Okay, in recent tweets, that makes more sense.
Oh, there we go.
There's the correction with another diamond. Thank you very much.
Should we announce the potential guest for next week?
Oh, yeah. Yes, we should.
This is so good, guys.
Zoom it out. I'll let you.
For next week?
Yeah. A fellow mutual.
So, next week, we potentially have Paul Scalise.
Lindy Mann.
We'll be talking about what's Lindy, what's not Lindy, and the eternal question, is rape Lindy? Will be discussed next week on the podcast.
And his new book, The 4-Hour Life, 4HL.
We also have a big show the week after that. On the 14th.
Oh yeah, big show.
We're gonna leave that. Kind of in the dark, but you won't want to miss it. I'll just say that. That'll be like the grand finale of the year. That'll be the most entertaining show.
Absolutely. That's going to be fantastic. You know, watch us tease that out of it. It should be pretty epic.
Yeah.
What do we have on the stream here?
Oh, I'm just finding funny shit on Twitter.
So this girl, that was the girl that...
That's from Caspa's account.
Yeah, she sent that girl sent me a message on my PayPig account that was like, she sent me a nude of herself, of just her ass. Like,
what?
It's like Hank Hill ass.
It's like a Hank Hill ass. So we've just been going off on her. That's a picture of the girl that sent it.
I wonder how many mixed children she has.
No. She looks like she's had a little too many.
I know, about as many Colby ones. Dak donates one diamond and says, is this show once a week, specific time? The GroypCast is on Saturdays at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, but we do have drawing streams and sometimes regular streams throughout the week, and we announce that on our Telegram and our Twitter, so keep your eye out for those.
If you have the DLive app, you can subscribe with notifications.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, if you want to subscribe, you get I think it's like 300 lemons a month. You get that little base thing next to your name. And you also get to call in if you want. We're going to do a call-in show soon. So that's kind of the benefits if you want to throw us some lemons that way as well.
And follow Charlotte's PayPig posting. Some girl tried to threaten revenge porn charges on him.
Yeah, you're burning through accounts lately.
Yeah, I know. But that's definitely not me. It's a friend.
That's yeah.
The account.
You would never evade Twitter bans.
No.
Yeah. None of us would.
No, me either.
My Twitter, Gibby's back.
These are all fan accounts. These are just odes to our kings ran by other people.
Oh, big man money wagey with the diamond says, I'm going to call into the next one.
Yeah, call it.
Yeah, definitely call in. We'll have a call-in show sometime. We'll do it next week. I'm sure we'll have the time.
Oh, that's right. I did set that up in Discord, so we should be pretty good.
Epic. And Birdie Bra donates one diamond says, when's this call-in show? We'll do it. Next show, so it'd be next Saturday.
Yeah, we'll do it next Saturday.
Birdie nationalism.
Should we make our viewers talk to Paul Scalise?
They probably should. Oh, ask him what's Lindy. Like, have a question. Is this Lindy? And you can ask
it. He hates that. Do it.
It'll be perfect. Yeah, absolutely.
I need lots of preparation for this for my kings, please.
Charlie,
if you have his book, bring his book. Quick.
My what?
Your mentions is what Zoomer historian's telling you.
Ah, okay.
We could do a call-in tonight.
Oh, hold on one second here.
Yeah, who's down? I'm down to do a call-in.
I'd be down.
How long?
This is what Zoomer historian...
Yeah, I guess we could. Yeah. Let's just do it.
I'll ask some people. Yo, DM me if you want to call in at V3ZoomerNatFan. DM me.
No gamer words.
Yeah, everyone already knew like Cobb was 1791 L guy.
Yeah, so in case you're wondering where this all came from, this guy. I don't know what else. I don't know what else to say.
He was in full simp mode with Colpy. That was like the most egregious thing. Him and who's the other guy?
Young Peck.
Yeah, Peck. Peck was simping hard for her too.
Glon was right. Simping too.
Yeah. And I love how she came back and she just like pretended nothing happened when we all know it was like full breakdown mode a day earlier.
Well, apparently Simp Central is this group chat called like the book club. And this is like, it's only e-girls and simps from what I understand. So you have people like Holpe, Cobb. I think Glon is like head of it, if I'm not mistaken, and this is the epicenter. This is like the opposite of Groiper group chats. These are our enemies. Like in those tower defense games, when you fight against another tower and they're spawning the enemies.
Yeah, we have Shallot on screen right now.
Who's that handsome man?
Yo, all I'm saying is you're in a dark alley and this man walks up to you asking you for feed pics. What do you do?
Okay, Zoomer historians apparently saying the book club is anti-simp. I don't know, I'm not a part of it, but I just know, aren't these people a part of it, like Colpy and like Sydney, a lot of e-girls, and then like Glon and all these simps.
I guess.
Maybe I think Zoomer Historian, are you thinking of the YouTube channel, The Book Club? I'm not talking about him. He's epic. Everyone subscribed to Book Club on YouTube. It's not the person I'm referring to, though.
You guys see the people trying to say Nick was like a Chinese plant today? I thought that was pretty funny.
Oh, yeah. That's just retarded. Any call-in requests?
Yeah, I did. I'm going to try to add someone right now.
Hey, Gibby, did you see our Andre Rush video came through?
Oh, shit, no. Where is it? It's on Twitter?
Check my timeline.
Oh, wait, is it not the Daily Groper timeline?
I asked them to retweet it.
Oh, you should have sent it into the Daily Groper.
Hang on a sec.
I'll send it in.
Let me find this really quick, and I'll get it going here.
I just got it right before the show, so I wanted to shoot it out. It's fucking hilarious.
What's your ad again, Phil? Is it DSA?
DSA underscore Phil.
I was going Phil
first.
Epic
rebrand.
The most epic rebrand.
Yeah.
Okay, just checked it out. Someone pull up Parker's video. That's fantastic.
All right. Hang on. Hello?
Hey. Yo, what's up? Is this Birdie?
This is Birdie. Yes.
What's going on, big guy? What's up?
Hey, your name is on your thing.
Oh shit!
It's just the first name.
You're just gonna see Juan. Yeah. I've been exposed already.
What's going on, Juan?
Do you want Charlotte's dogs to make you feel better?
Oh, all right, hang
so,
on. Me,
how's everybody doing tonight?
Good.
Good. How are you?
Very good.
We're going to play something real quick, Juan. So just everyone should mute their mics for a sec while
all right.
I play this.
All right.
Hey, Richard. I know you love a good burger and melted Swiss cheese, roasted mushroom, caramelized onion, all that good hot stuff. You can get that in a number of different places, but you can also get it in Daily Grouper. Check it out. Hey, Richard, I know you love a good burger.
No audio on the stream, bro.
Oh, no, it's there. It's just not on the call.
Oh, it is?
Sorry.
Oh.
Yeah. That was great, dude. Great job, Parker,
getting
that cameo.
Amazing.
Daily Groyper shout out at the end. Perfect.
Yeah. What do you say? It was like Daily
Grouper.
He botched it a little bit, but yeah. The best one was the Indian kid.
Well, my quality is pretty bad, so I'm just going to say Birdie Nationalism and head out.
All right, man.
Thanks, Juan.
Thanks for coming on.
See ya.
Bye. See
ya. He's got such a common name, though, that like it doesn't do anything. He's good.
That's just a heads up for everyone else that's coming in.
Yeah. Don't use your real Gmail.
Because I had first and last name.
Yeah, we should actually get Book Club, the YouTuber, on the GroypCast. He would be a really good guest. He's kind of has this like chaotic Groyper energy to him. I'll reach out to him and see if he wants to be a guest.
I'm so jacked for Paul.
Oh yeah, that's gonna be awesome. We got great guests so far and great guests lined up.
Yep. Fantastic. Remember what Paul did to Contbot though.
Oh, well,
podcast and shit all over.
Expect that to happen. He's absolutely going to shit on us.
If people don't think that we love haters, they haven't been watching closely enough. We love people throwing shit at us. It is fine.
His critique was that he carried the podcast. So
maybe we'll be a little bit quiet, a little bit soft-spoken in the beginning, but eventually we'll get to the point.
You can watch his Lindy streams that he does every day. Fucking awesome.
Dak donates one diamond, says we want more Juan. I don't think we're going to get more Juan tonight, but I kind of wish we had a bit more, too. Any more callers, Zoom or Nat?
Potentially. Let's see. Give it a minute.
Let's do a prank call show.
That could be good.
Yeah, we could set up a few.
Get some numbers. Get some
e-girls.
Oh, yeah.
We have a new conspiracy in the chat. I apparently sound like Charlie Kirk.
Oh, there you go.
Very on brand.
I can't let this leave the GroypCast.
Dak,
very
donate,
observant.
One lemon, it says, thoughts on Stefan Molyneux and cucking about Nick. We already kind of covered that a bit. Like, it's unfortunate because he's usually on point when it comes to things like demographics and a lot of the key issues for our side. But it's just, like, it's optics cucking, but not in, like, I don't want to be a wig nat. It's optics cucking and, like, oh, this guy that I had on my show once who I've throwed in the past up until very recently, I'm just going to, like, be duplicitous and be, like, a little feminine bitch and be like, oh, I completely... Dude, turn off your video. Please turn
I
off
did.
Okay.
I did. it was up at my ceiling. Yeah.
And your forehead.
Okay. Well, let's get forehead. On to the caller.
Yeah.
How are you doing, Bit?
Sorry. Yeah, I'm on a phone, but I thought it was interesting that Steve Franssen was talking about Brittany Venti, because there was a period where she was hanging out with Lauren Southern, where Lauren was trying to get her to be sort of like an ethot. And it seems like she didn't take to that very well, and she did the right thing. So he's very apt in talking about that, because Lauren Southern went the ethot way and then kind of ducked out. And you look at what, you know, has come out about her. But Brittany Venti, you don't see, you know, any bad things about her, except people call her, oh, she's a white supremacist or stuff like that.
Are you sure you don't see any bad things about Brittany Venti? Have you read the Daily Groyper? We had a whole article about bad things said.
I haven't read the Daily Groyper.
What?
So.
Fuck.
Oh, okay. Kick him. He's out.
No. All right. So,
You should from now on.
Disgusting.
Okay. So, what is, you know, wrong about her? I mean, I only saw her when she was, you know, going on live streams and stuff like that. I didn't follow her a whole lot.
Are you, I don't really get, what's your angle here?
There is no angle. I was just saying, it's interesting that Franssen says, oh, not Brittany Venti. God damn it. I'm talking about Brittany Pettibone.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a whole different...
Yeah, sorry, not Venti. Venti never hung out with Lauren Southern yet. My bad. I was talking about Pettibone. He was talking about Pettibone, how she just kind of supports. Like, she supports her husband. And Lauren Southern went out to get a name for herself, but they used to do streams together like 3 years ago. Lauren was trying to rope her in to try and be sort of the ethot thing. And
I agree, but like, it's clear that that's not really what... Now, I'm not a big fan of Brittany Pettibone. I personally think her content's like...
Neither am I.
But...
Well, it's boring. But isn't that what it should be?
She got married.
Because she's not appealing to you or me, like people that are digging into the issues, but she's appealing to women.
Yeah, but like, what's the question here?
Yeah, I mean, what are you going to question her on? She hasn't even really put herself out there that much. She did, I guess she wrote a book, right? I never read it, but...
I don't think any of us were questioning her.
Right. No, but so Steve Franssen, I'm just going back to like when Steve was on, and he made a point to say, hey, that she's a good example of what a political woman should be. Someone that's like, kind of boring, sitting in the back and being supportive.
Do you agree with that?
In general, I mean, unless she's going to be Ann Coulter and
I mean, like, do you agree with Steve's take on the way that he presented it and everything?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. I agree with that. I was listening to that.
Yeah, definitely. Because if you get someone like Lauren Southern, what is her, trying to get power going to do? I mean, it turns out she was pretty... not not traditional, even though she portrayed herself that way. She wasn't traditional about like who she was sleeping with. Apparently it was a lot of people, including like, you know, Paul Joseph Watson. And and she did it to get power. So when women are trying to get power, they have an easy tool, especially when they're young and relatively attractive. So a woman that's willing to forego that is, you know,
you gotta keep them in check. You gotta keep the pressure on.
I know it seems like I'm going hard. Just like, is this just reiterating what Steve Franssen was saying?
Yes. Well, no, it's more that he never went to the comparison when I think there's probably a period, not that it was ever out there, but that Lauren Southern was trying to bring her into the e-thought kind of realm, and she rejected it.
I mean, you talked about like e-girls and e-thoughts. You just didn't talk
But Lauren Southern is one of the worst examples of them. So when there's e-thoughts that are saying that they're based and they're making documentaries and stuff and they're making these huge projects, why do they get those huge projects? It's because they're putting out. And, you know, she went and hid away because she knew that was all going to come out. So the only reason she got power was because of her tits and her ass.
Well, Bit, let me ask you this question.
Yeah.
Jess Southern or Lauren Southern?
Oh, no.
Jess, because she didn't put herself out there politically and also put her ass out there.
I think we need Pilled Knight to
we need
join us on this one.
Well, Phil Knight said everything he needs to say on the subject in a current article that we have on the Daily Groyper called "The Conservative Case for Jess Posting." Go ahead and bring that up really quick.
Oh my God!
Does he have her birthday in there?
No, he doesn't. Which is kind of the thing. Yeah, well,
that's the X factor.
Yeah,
pretend like no one said anything about that.
Yeah, I didn't know it. I mean, you know.
Hey, but Bit chose Jess. Fantastic choice.
Yeah,
I think it's the correct choice. You can't blame a woman for being a thought, but if she's a political because of her thoughtery, then, or she gets clout because of it, then I think you can throw that away.
We will definitely blame both.
No, you can blame both. One is worse.
One is worse. I will say that. Yes.
Yeah.
Any other hot, steaming, hot caramelized onion takes you'd like to give us today, Bit?
Well, as long as there's roasted mushrooms, but I think I'll duck out with that.
Another correct take.
Thank you. Thank you, Bit. It was lovely having you.
Yep. Keep
Thanks,
it going.
Bit.
Who is Kevin?
Hello.
Hello, Kevin.
How are you guys doing? I'm D's Joker.
Oh, what's going on, man?
How are you guys doing?
Very good. And yourself?
I'm doing fine. You know, just chilling, watching the stream.
How'd you like the stream so far?
It was good. I missed most of it. I was trying to watch it on my iPad, but shit wasn't working.
That's too bad. Anything in particular you'd like to ask us Groypers on the Groypcast?
You know, I was thinking a little bit. I'm from South Africa, and a young man from South Africa, and things are going a little bit to shit over there, if you haven't noticed.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just like to know what you guys think someone like me should do in that situation. You know.
Well, I assume you're a white South African.
Yes, I'm a Boer.
Oh, nice, nice. Honestly, it sounds kind of bad. Probably just move to Australia. I don't see there being hope for South Africa.
Yeah, because right now I'm in the United States.
Oh, okay. You know?
Well, that's a good start.
Yeah. So, I'm not on any type of permanent, you know, plan or like residency or anything like that. So I would just like to get a hot take from someone.
Overstay your visa.
Yeah. I was wondering if I should, you know, be like a based immigrant or something illegal.
Oh, absolutely.
You should find some South African woman that lives here and marry her.
Oh no, they're all black, man.
I meant a white South African woman that lives in the United States.
Yeah, no, I'm playing.
And
yeah,
not Charlize though.
Be one way that you could do it. You could marry the black South African, getting good, you know, say all the right things, but then that you have a medical complication, so you can't have children with her, but that you love her, right?
Yeah. I see what you're getting at.
You slowly work your way in, right? And then next thing you know, that's right. It was rigged from the beginning.
Then you're voting.
Start.
Yeah. Excuse me?
Oh, it's a game was rigged from the start. It's a Fallout New Vegas reference.
Yeah, no, but yeah, I love the United States. It's, but you know where I'm at. You can slowly start seeing the decline of. Yeah. It's getting a lot more like South Africa.
I mean, your country is pretty much like Fallout.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like getting the game. Like I used to play Fallout a lot, and just like. Comparing it to how it is in South Africa, I was like, this is like real life. This is like going to the store.
I didn't know how bad it was. I see videos, like there was that thing like a month or two ago of like people getting burned alive and macheted in the middle of the street. It's just like, wow.
Was that clip of the white kid picking up garbage as the black girls take it out of the garbage? Was that from South Africa? Do you guys remember that video?
Yeah, that's the EFF. That's the like the biggest opposition party. Protesting at some university about. I think it was about like the fact that it was an Afrikaans school, and they say, "Oh, that's like they only teach in Afrikaans, and that's racist towards all the other people who can't speak Afrikaans." So, yeah, they were protesting, and they were just, you know, the way these people protest is they like. Burn everything down. They just trash everything. And this one kid, you know, bless his heart, came up and just tried to pick up the trash. And I think he got like dragged for that. You know, they were saying, oh, he's racist or for trying to pick up the trash, you know. But
if you've ever lived in Los Angeles, it's basically what it is. It's one big white person just picking up the garbage for everybody else.
Yeah. Seems like it, man.
Yeah, it definitely is a tragic situation that happened over there, and you can definitely see that from the, you know, the governmental leadership that's there. That definitely drips down to like what you see on the street level, and that's sort of the problem. And that's we've been sort of blessed with having a little bit of you know, hope and a little bit of wiggle room because we had Trump, but. You know, that's probably the only thing that could really sort of change things to a big degree is a change in leadership in South Africa.
For
something like that to happen, that'd be miraculous.
We're glad you're here, man.
It'd be pretty hard.
What was the backstory on that like huge situation that happened like a couple months back where there was like. What was it with like the Nigerians or whatever?
Oh yeah. Like, okay. So this is like in the, it's in Johannesburg and, in like the central of the city, like, you know, I would compare it to like New York, like kind of like the stock exchange or like the big hub, you know, like where all the business takes place and stuff like that. But there was like, a rundown area where like Nigerian immigrants, well, not just Nigerians, but a lot of immigrants from Africa were just like setting up shops, selling illegal stuff. And those, you know, like Nigerians, Malawians, and people from Uganda, I think. But now the native, like the Zulus and those types of people were like, these guys are here illegally and they're like stealing our jobs and they're stealing our customers and we want them out. Now the difference is like here, you know, people petition, people vote. Over there they just go up right up to the people and just like set them on fire. I'm pretty sure some of you have seen the videos.
Yeah, necklace.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Like I kind of I don't know, I'm on the fence about that, You know, on the one side, I'm like, oh, you can't just go and set people on fire. But on the other hand, I'm like, it's pretty based.
Yeah, got to hear both sides.
Yeah, you know, they just want to get rid of illegals, you know. But.
And then what? They like evacuated them. I saw they had like a plane get some of them out of there, like to go home.
Yeah, some of them left on planes and some of them left on buses. Yeah, a lot of people were saying like it's very funny because the media in South Africa is very it's also very corrupt. So they were trying to spin it as, oh no, these poor Nigerians, this is so xenophobic, what's going on in the country? But you know, it was like it's crazy. And a lot of the videos, like I've been to some of those places before. Like sitting here in the United States, I see videos of a guy, you know, being pelt with rocks, and I'm like, oh, I've been there. So none of it's fake, and it went over really quickly. I don't know what happened. I think there was like a media blackout on what happened over there, but yeah, it's just from being South Africa, there's always something to be, you know, outraged about.
So how did like you as a South African kind of find out about the Groypers and this side of Twitter, the side of politics?
Oh, it's very interesting because I would say it was around 2014. It's just YouTube, you know. I was watching PewDiePie like just like you know back then, and then I started getting recommended videos, and then I think around I don't remember if it was in London or in France or something, but there was an attack, like an Islamic attack, and I got really interested about that, and then I saw a Paul Joseph Watson video.
So you kind of went down the pipeline.
Yeah, exactly. And
yeah, the pipeline's pretty epic.
It is. It was pretty. I remember it was Paul Joseph Watson, then it was Milo, then I watched Ben Shapiro, and it just, you know, I'm pretty sure a lot of people can relate to this, but being in South Africa, being so far removed, I opened my Twitter account, and I had like a Boer Groyper avatar, and I was just in the thick of things. I think Parker Maverick is in the call. I used to follow him way back when. I think he.
Oh, back when he was actually Parker.
Yeah, just Parker.
Yeah,
yeah, and I remember all of these accounts, and so I was just in this like in the middle of everything. It was like I was just an observer, you know,
yeah,
from the outside, wishing like, damn, I wish something like that would happen, you know, in South Africa.
Now, did you discover like all this when you were in South Africa, or after you moved to America?
No, while I was in South Africa.
Cause, this is pretty wild.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think the whole Boer mentality is already like it's very libertarian. Because I've always been a conservative, I would say at heart, but I was also being young. I was also very liberal about things, and. I think it was easier for me to get like interested in stuff like this, in politics and what's going on in the United States, because of the history of South Africans, you know, the Boers especially.
Now, what do you think about like Boer organizations or organizations that like purport to help the Boer, like Sidelanders and groups like that? Do you think they're effective? Do you think like they're actually working towards a good future, or?
I personally, I think some of what they do is good work. Like I believe they do a lot of self-defense training and you know, preparation, how to be like self-sustaining on your own. Because in South Africa, that is necessary. People need to, like, a lot of people that I know are rain collectors and stuff like that, and solar panels, because you know, every time it rains in South Africa, there's no power, and so they do a lot of that stuff, like just self-sustaining stuff, and I think that's effective. But at the end of the day, I don't really see like a future for white people in South Africa. It's sad to say, because you know, there's so much history. And I think South Africa, the country in itself, is older than the United States. Like the founding of South Africa is older than that of the United States.
Oh yeah, the first like Dutch settlement was way before the United States.
Yeah, I think it was in 1664, 1684, something like that. But yeah, there's a lot of history in South Africa and a lot of fighting and a lot of blood that has gone into the country, and to see it just being slowly but surely taken away is
it's sad. Depressing. Yeah,
kind of black pill.
But a white pill is D's Joker. I followed you for a while. He's a great account. Everyone should follow him.
Absolutely, everyone go follow him. It's at.
I'll put his Twitter in the the chat.
At Sweet. Joker fan account on Twitter.
Everyone and follow Biggie Slunk. That man drops videos.
Oh yeah, he's shit. Great.
Great Biggie Slunk.
Yeah,
we've got a base Jaden in chat. What's up, Jaden?
Yeah.
No, that's the funny thing is of watching Nicholas, is that what really like convinced me that he knew what he was talking about is that when he I don't remember exactly the episode it was, but he talked about it becoming like the United States becoming like 1% of the population, like this upper class that just owns everything, and then this lower class that just, you know, they just want to consume, they just want to see the new Avengers movie, the IQ is around like 75, just
drooling. I mean, that's the current trajectory right now.
Yeah, and that's literally how South Africa is. I mean, you see people like driving like beat up cars, and that's considered the middle class. And then you see people like this, like in this fancy Mercedes, just driving down, owning, like she probably owns like a bus company or something like that, driving around like people from work. That's what really got me into Nick is that the way he speaks, you can actually, the way he says things, you can see it coming true in like the United States, but it has been like that in South Africa for quite a while.
I agree. It's pretty interesting how you can kind of see what's on the horizon with that. And especially just kind of like how the demographic situation panned out there and you know, how much worse it got for the, white population. I think it's just kind of, I mean, because is it like really bad if you go in like the kind of metro areas? Like, are you likely to be, you know, looked at or approached and stuff like that? I'm guessing it is.
Oh yeah. No, I remember we went to a safari parks are a big thing in South Africa, and I remember we went to a safari park with my family, and we went into like a little grocery store, but I would say we were the only white people in the store, and we were just getting looked at, like, because we're relatively middle class, and we were just getting like funny looks all the time, and I was with my dad. I think I was 13 at the time, and I remember this big black guy coming up to my dad and like he like interjected himself, like he and my dad wanted to get by him, but he didn't want to move, and he kept looking my dad in the eye, kind of like threatening him.
Right.
And that just constant feeling about, you know, being the other, you know, being having to look behind your shoulder if someone following you to your car. And that's everywhere now.
You've got to have a lot of people have like really significant security there, right? If they're right by the, like, don't some people have like guards and stuff like that? Like,
yeah, everyone has like a private security like company that they like employ to, you know, just patrol around the area.
Yeah,
but even these, like, because they carry firearms, like a lot of like the gang members in South Africa target them to get their firearms. And there's a lot of videos I'm sure you can find.
Oh, they target the security people?
Yeah, they target the security guys and try to steal their weapons.
Jesus, that's kind of crazy.
Yeah, so even then, you know, you might have your own private security. Yeah, you might be able to afford it in the first place, but you're still in danger, you know? And the laws, the way the laws are set up in South Africa, yes, you can. It's not that difficult to get a gun, but the law is that if someone breaks into your house and they only have like a knife, for example, you can't shoot them because you have to use the same amount of force that they want to use onto you. So you can only use your firearm if they have a firearm. So it's very, I question the intent behind the people who set up those laws. Because then it gives all these people that say, that talk about white genocide, a lot of credibility. Because it honestly feels like that in South Africa.
Yeah, yeah. And you've got it going on with the farms, obviously. I mean,
oh yeah. Yeah, it's everywhere like that. I would say the farmers are more targeted because they're more rural. So there's not the chances of police getting by or someone coming to help are very low. But everywhere, I would say, where my family lives in South Africa, it's very it's not as rural, but it's dense, and every week someone gets shot maybe in the neighborhood of people trying to break in.
Yeah, that's crazy. I mean, I'm guessing it'll be like a kind of Rhodesia situation. Like once all the farmers leave, they'll probably have like super bad inflation and it'll just go like completely to shit. So
yeah. Yeah. It's sad to say, but it is true.
I don't want to blackpill you too hard. Maybe you guys have some.
No, I've been blackpilled since I was born, man.
Yeah. Damn, that's tough.
Yeah. Oh. No. But yeah, it's getting worse. Every time I go back to visit, it's just, you know, going to shit. Yeah, especially with how things are going now. China trying to buy its way into Africa. It's not making things easier.
It's just a horrible situation. It's a dark situation on the dark continent. Yeah. Africa is just it's a hellhole. It's a shithole. Like, all of it. North Africa, South Africa, East, West, Central, all of it.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's that 85 IQ at work, you know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Is it that high?
Being generous there.
Yeah. It's the white population that's just giving it a little bit of a boost.
Oh yeah. It's probably like 105 and then like 70.
Yeah. Yeah, no, because I heard somewhere in the news recently in South Africa that they are, because it used to be that you graduated high school in the 12th grade, but now they're making it, because a lot of the kids, like the black kids, can't graduate. They can't, you know, meet the required level to graduate. So now they're trying to make it that you can graduate high school at the 9th grade.
Oh, they're just trying to
Set the bar a little lower, you know.
That never works. That's the thing. They're gonna learn, like, when you cave to underperforming groups like that, it just comes around to bite you in the ass. Like, the whole system ends up going to shit.
Yeah. Yeah, it's already shit.
Yeah, but I mean, even worse. I mean, that's not going to do anything productive. But, yeah, isn't unemployment a huge thing there?
Yeah, I think, I can't remember the statistic specifically, but I think 50% of South Africa's youth is unemployed.
Yeah, that's insane.
Yeah. The unemployment is at a 25%.
Right. And when you mix that with like the low IQ, that's just a recipe for disaster.
Yeah. It's just low IQ people just sitting at home.
Right. That's how you get themselves. The people getting lit on fire and beheaded in the street.
Yeah. I saw someone said in the chat, like, how's the RAND doing? Yeah, the RAND's terrible.
What's the RAND?
Yeah. The currency of South
Africa. Oh.
Yeah, it's fucking shit. Yeah.
Yeah, short that if you can.
I'll get on that. Stonks, bro. I'll get on that.
Big Money Wagey in the chat says, pour one out for my SA Kings, my South African Kings. Absolutely. We're going sips up for the Kings.
I appreciate it.
Let's sip some for the Kings.
Cheers. I got some. Cheers.
I have water.
Me too.
Sip it.
Yeah.
This is for the boar. In the chat. What's going on, Phil?
Not much. Just I just heard that other guy, the previous caller calling, so I had to hop in.
What's up?
Just not defender.
Much. Exactly. I gotta defend. Gotta defend the queen. Now, people don't get it. They don't get it at all. They take it too far and they don't get the message behind just posting. They gotta read the article and go to the end, go to the reasoning why. Okay. They don't get it. They just don't.
It's not that
complicated either.
I get it.
Yeah, he gets it.
Yeah.
It's esoteric.
I'm thankful for all my internet friends.
Oh, yeah. Internet friends are better than real friends.
Exactly.
E-friends better than IRL friends.
Yeah.
Got any final thoughts?
No, not really. Just want to say keep up what you guys are doing.
Thanks, man.
It's fucking fantastic. I love it.
Hey, good to talk to you.
Keep supporting, keep watching. Thanks for coming in.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
All right. God bless.
Love Jack. You guys.
Yeah, see you, man. Good talk.
God bless you.
Dak says, missed a bunch of super chats. I don't know. What did
I miss? We were letting the guy talk. We didn't want to like interrupt or anything. But we got Big Money Wages. We got a lot of people super chats still.
Can we get his Twitter? I posted it. I just posted it in the chat.
Do we have any more callers?
I shouted it out too on Twitter.
We might, but let's just keep finishing it out if we don't. I don't see your... Like, I might miss your diamond because it doesn't, like, stay on the top of the chat. The only thing that stays up there is a Ninjagini, so... If I miss the diamond, sorry, but gets lost sometimes.
Yeah, that was a good call. It was a really good call, actually. Very informative.
I think this has been one of the most grounding, I guess you could say, Groypcasts we'll probably ever have.
Yeah, because it's
we
like
have
real
calm
things.
Steve, and then we have, you know, some real shit in South Africa going down and all this stuff.
Yeah, we think of this as all like fun and games, and it is. But when and if our side loses, it will become a similar situation to South Africa. It will become like a kind of a hellhole, hellscape like that. And that's why we need to support our king, support people like Nick, Patrick, Jake, Scott, Steve,
us,
and just us, of course. Just send a couple more ninjas for us.
It's just, but I think it's just. It serves as a vindication for what our ideas are and, you know, what we're working towards. Like, some people are like, oh, like, do you really think anything will happen? Like, why are you freaking out over all these semantics? It's like, yes, it will. Look at all these other places where it has. And then ask yourself again. And it's just... kind of reminds everyone that you got to keep your head in the game. You got to remember why we're doing this, and you got to remember what will happen.
you know.
Yeah. Well, I actually got docked out. I got to do something, but it's a good GroypCast. It's fun to host. Fun. Great having Steve Franssen on. He was a great guest. Y'all can follow me at Gibby's Back on Twitter. Or no, wait, it's not at Gibby's Back. I totally fucked that up. You can follow me at Gibby Gibbs on Twitter, but the I in Gibbs is a lowercase L.
Big Money Weed. All right, see you, Gibby. Good to talk to you. Big Money Weed you with the five diamonds. Thanks, big guy. Dak with the diamond. He says, bow to buy short shorts, a bulldozer, and go to South Africa. Yeah, dude, pull off there. See what you can do.
It looks like we got someone else in the call here. Terrifying. Avi. Absolutely terrifying. But you're muted. Go ahead and unmute yourself.
Yeah, what's up, O3?
Yeah, what's up, bros? My name's O3. You can call me Danny. But I'm here to talk about the demographics question.
What's up with that?
Yeah, so my city, we used to be like 90% white. Cool. And like now we're like 50. And it's depressing. Like everything's gone to garbage. So I'm just here to say, like, pretty much everyone who thinks that this isn't a problem, like they're in the middle-ish, they think that it won't come to them, it will. And all it'll bring is like high crime. Like every night, sirens, gunshots. It sucks, bro. I want to get out of here.
Like, yeah, it happened quick. The 90 to 50, it happened like relatively quickly.
It happened in like less than 20 years.
Yeah, that's nuts. That's crazy.
And it's not just the cities. People like in the suburbs or rural areas think they're going to be safe. Not true. Just a little anecdote from me. If you ever moved out from like where you grew up as a kid, go back to where you moved out from. Like personally me, I moved out like halfway through middle school. But after I graduated high school, I went back to my neighborhood I grew up in. Completely changed. Everyone moved out. New people moved in. It's not the same. And it was a suburb, too. It wasn't in a big city. It wasn't a city. It was a suburb. And it's completely gone.
Yeah, like, I saw pictures of from, like, 20 to 30 years ago. Like, a little bit more than that. And it looks like a completely different place. Like, unrecognizable. Like, there's no garbage in the streets. There's, like, it's actually clean. You want to live there. But we had, like, this big, nice park. And now it's just a dump. And, like, they have to keep building new apartment complexes because everyone here is poor and they can't
move out.
Affordable
housing, yeah.
Exactly.
And you get these shitty-ass tenants who
we all know who owns them, but...
Yeah.
Yeah. My bad. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that, but...
I don't think
it's you can say it. You can say it.
You know, it's funny because one of the, like, the daughter of the person who, like, owns most of the tenants, she goes to my school. And, like, we dunk on her a lot for that. The rich girl, but...
People who are complicit, like...
Yeah, they're complicit.
You
got to
shame
them,
too.
Exactly. They're all, like, participating in it, you know? It's just depressing, really. But I'm trying to get moving out, you know? Try starting a family outside of here, but... I'm just 16 right now, so I can't really do much about my situation.
Yeah, I mean... That's hopefully you'll get out of there soon, but you just got to kind of grind through it, you know?
Yeah. Well, thanks for having me on, bros. You know, I try being cool, but like I've never been on like a live stream before, you know? So it's like a lot of jitters. I feel like Joker when he's watching Bruce Wayne or Thomas Wayne. My bad.
Like, you're good, man.
Well, thanks for having me.
You did well. Thanks for sharing the story.
All right, bye.
See ya.
It's true. And that happens all over the place. And it's just, a lot of times you'll get people that live in these areas and they say, well, if I start holding these views, then I'm going to be seen as a racist or something like this. So I can't support these things because of the social societal consequences. But there is also a point, too, where it doesn't actually matter what people say about you because it's not like every person is racist on the planet because they want their country to be the same. But you have to make a decision that you know, this is bad and there is a reason to stand up for it. And it goes much deeper than like any sort of, you know, buzzword that they're coming up with. It has to deal with loving the ground that you were born in.
Yeah. And I mean, another problem is just like the ignoring of the issue, you know, like even if, you know, the area's going to shit, it's like, oh, well, I'll just blame the mayor, or I'll just blame the, you know,
the Democrats.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, the other side isn't doing too hot either.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
Because we got, you know, you got Mike Lee that goes and pushes the certain types of visa policies so that we can get all these people from India and other places in here so that they can take all the STEM jobs.
Oh yeah, that's a disaster.
And that puts pressure down on people that actually have, you know, 80, 100, 120K worth of college debt. And they were promised, you know, if you get this degree, you'll get this type of job. And people went and took that wager, and now they're being left out in the dirt because, you know, it's not that they're necessarily incompetent. It's because there are other interests at play other than your livelihood. Sorry.
Someone in the, someone says HB 711. Yeah, basically. It's a good one.
Apu reference. Shallot, have you seen any of that?
Enlighten me.
Like demographics within the STEM industry.
Oh yeah, I mean, I went to school for the STEM area, and now I mean I do development, so it's definitely like one of the top issues that I'm concerned with. One of my first jobs right out of school was working with managing a group of Ukrainians, actually. So the fact of outsourcing and even bringing in people to do the work for us, which is just creating competition unnecessarily, is at the forefront of my concern. I'm 5 years into my career, so my anticipation and how I'm circumventing that worst case scenario is taking advantage of my English skills as well as my personality traits to move on up to management and being able to get out of the, I guess it's not necessarily low class, that's not the right term, but the jobs that are going to get eaten up, which is the developer work. And that's a fear in my industry amongst my peers as well.
Yeah, like the worker bees, not necessarily like low skill labor, but you know, developers are people that are, you know, really sort of putting their head down and really grinding out the work.
Correct. As soon as the Indians learn to speak English well, this industry is fucked. Because you can already go ahead and outsource some work just through those job posting sites with getting people to develop stuff for you for pennies. They just don't have enough work over there. Now, granted, the content that you're getting back is not, I mean, you're getting what you pay for. However, if you can even speak relatively to the development work that you're asking for, you can get it for dirt cheap. The reason it's paid for over here by companies that, I mean, they just want stuff that's done well. They want input and feedback from the developers that understand the business need and help to not only create the product, but offer insight. Hey, this is what we've done with other projects, etc. You just don't get that feedback from non-native English speaking people. And yeah, so that's kind of my experience with it. That's something that's down the line. It is a concern of mine. I do not wish that upon anybody else that's up and coming.
It's going to happen, which is the bad part. Like, it's, I feel like it's writing on the wall unless something happens quick, you know?
Oh yeah. No, I mean, I'm definitely preparing for it already. And I've got a head start on, I imagine most of you, younger folk out there. I'm not terribly old, but, it's something to concern yourself with, and like the stapling of the green cards to the diploma stuff, that's talk is very scary.
Yeah.
And that does need to be addressed immediately. I know this is just a common cliche, so to speak, of, hey, let's shut the borders down and figure out what the hell is going on. I mean, that's just very common, but how else do you address it?
The conversation needs to be had. The fact that like something like this can happen and there's no public hearing and no one even knows about it except for those who are really involved, it's just crazy.
Yeah, I think Shell, you have a good point. Just to sort of wrap this up really quick, is that management is in charge of things like hiring and things like that, and being able to, who are we going to give a visa to? Who are we going to give a sponsorship to? Things like this, so that that sort of gives these people that foot in the door. Whereas if you get into that sort of management position, you are a little bit more closer in control to those types of decisions, and you can sort of figure out where the best work you're going to get. And I mean, it's pretty obvious, like you said, like a lot of the stuff that comes from, you know, these places is not the best work. The best work that you'll find is right here, homegrown.
That's, yeah, absolutely. And everyone knows that. The people that go into, just speaking from my industry, the people that go into development for web applications or phone applications, whatever kind of need they have, they do not understand how much it costs typically. So that is an outlet that they'll kind of pursue at first, maybe. Now, granted, you have bigger firms that would not go that route, but it is definitely viable. Like the company we had in the Ukraine, their kind of guy in charge, the middleman, so to speak, he spoke English very well. Now, when you talk to the developers, not at all.
Yeah.
So if you have
a big mess.
Correct. And if you have those people that kind of pop up that maybe get an education over here and then go back home, well, then that's still kind of the same concept, you know? Mm-hmm. And so,
or if they're here with the stapling green cards and they just
stay,
come on over and stay, and then yeah, you're fucked.
So the let's shut the shit down and figure out what the hell's going on is, it sounds silly and it sounds not like, okay, this is the solution, but it needs to be the solution, in my opinion.
Yeah, Dak with the Ninja Genie, thanks, guy. He says, I sell to Indians, Pakis, etc., who are here. Most are 90 IQ max. All industries will soon be overrun. Yeah, I mean, it's unfortunate, but it's looking that way. We'll see what happens. Maybe we can turn the ship around, maybe not.
Neon Hot Tea brought up a good point. He said, now their code is getting into airline computing. I mean, we had that recently with, I think, the Boeing crash.
Multiple crashes.
Dak says, if you think your field is safe, you are delusional. Yeah. I mean, you got to really consider it if you're picking right now. You got to look at the long-term viability, especially with the automation on top of all this outsourcing. It's going to be a real pinch for what's actually available in the future, long-term at least.
Yeah, that's definitely true, and it's interesting. I mean, I know Yang Gang is a meme, but him addressing the Democratic debate, what's the 21st century terror threat? Well, you've got China with their focus on AI. Well, compounded with that, you have companies like Google who are going over there, modifying their company structure to accommodate the Chinese. And expedite that AI, because if I'm not mistaken, in order to get a business in China, they will require at least 50% ownership from some Chinese nationalist.
Right.
And that includes all your patent laws and probably through means of so to speak, cyber warfare. You have infiltration of kind of like a spy aspect. So they're getting not just what's on paper, but probably everything underneath.
Yeah.
And I imagine that's what's going on with Google. And it's pretty nefarious when you have a company that big that's receiving the benefits that they are receiving in the United States, just going back and kind of it's slapping you in the face.
Yeah. KV says, very cozy show here, gentlemen. Thanks. Zach says,
thank you.
We can stop it, but it has to be now. Yeah, it definitely has to be before it gets too late. Because once it's actually a big issue, then it's too late.
We need like AOC climate change hysteria type of...
We need McCarthy with this, yeah.
Yeah. Absolute hysteria on the immigration stuff.
Right. It's good to get your insight, though, Charlotte.
And the outsourcing.
Yeah, no.
They just need to be punished, those companies that do that.
Well, obviously, I don't know if punishment is the necessary correct way to go about it. I think more of, well, if you call punishment rescinding those benefits, then
yeah. That's what I'm saying, financially.
Yes. We should de-incentivize their at-home tax benefits or any government subsidies they receive. Well, and yeah, I think punishment is the way to go to deter that behavior from now.
Yeah.
If you have Microsoft receiving $1 million fine per day for bundling Internet Explorer and their operating system in the 90s, it pales into comparison to what companies get away with now.
Oh, yeah.
So it really, that's anti-libertarian, and that's this anti- current status quo within the conservative music movement, which is the pro-capitalism, which I think we all kind of agree on here. We're not pro-corporate America. We're pro-America. We're pro-American, and we value the people. And I can go on for this for all day.
No, but I think, you hire 10,000 H-1Bs, you got to hit a huge penalty.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. To the point where you're not, to the point where you're not hiring those people and you're hiring people at home. And the fact that they're even over here is kind of scary to begin with, right?
Find them and then lock them up. If they don't listen, start throwing people in jail.
Honestly. If you find them more than they're saving to hire those people, they'll stop doing it.
Right.
Right. Yeah, you don't even have to punish them. You can just deter the behavior. And the fact that they're getting over here through this outrageous college system, which I know probably a lot of y'all are going through. I'm out of that system altogether. My youngest brother is in it at the moment, and it's outrageous. Even with extracurriculars that you want to do, you have to make certain financial decisions. And the fact that that system in itself kind of,
That's a huge mess.
It rewards that behavior of getting these people over here because you're just populating those schools. It's a whole circle.
Then they give them scholarships too based on those things.
Dak with the diamond says construction companies are the biggest offenders. Yeah, they're really bad as far as like the proportion of people who are actually not supposed to be here.
Yeah.
Well, what did Steve call it? The 8 a.m. chainsaw. Thing, because I saw somebody at 7 a.m. running a lawnmower the other day, and it was just like that resonated with me so well, right?
It's we're like grinding, these people are grinding.
Yeah, it's like you can't mow your lawn at noon.
Yeah. Well, this has been a good conversation. I'm gonna go ahead and open the chest now. Do you guys have anything else you want to add?
Instead of, because this was pretty blackpilling, I'll play some nice exiting music for us, some chill tunes for us to exit to once we're done.
All right,
Charlotte, thanks for that.
In a minute,
Charlotte, thanks for that insight, man.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, gonna get someone who actually has experience in one of those fields. You hear all the time, coding is the most valuable skill, you know, all this, but it's like, okay, for how long, you know, if it really is, it's going to end up being being outsourced and replaced.
Yeah. Coding definitely protects people from the AI situation, like losing your job to AI. Cause if you're a dev, then you're good. But the other problem is exactly what Shell was talking about.
All right. Are you the one that's going to be hired? Got some good lemons going out.
Looks like Dak and Big Money Wagey and Based are top three. Oh, and Groyperwave in fourth. There we go.
Thanks, GW.
Yeah, GW will be doing some drawing streams this week, so you'll be sure to tune in.
Those are great.
I think a certain Parker might jump on one of those.
Yes, the notorious Parker.
Dak says, this was fun, ladies. Great show. Yeah, thanks, buddy. All right, well, thanks everyone for stopping by.
Thank you, guys.
Get us sent out here. Y'all have a great rest of your night.
Peace out.
Adios. live two worlds that aren't.